Good morning everybody, and welcome to this very blustery, grey, gunmetal, skied, scudding, clouded dawn here in the African wilderness. One should always breathe while speaking, Bryan. Goodness, what a start. My name is James Henry, on camera today is Bryan. Hello, Bryan.
Hello, James.
Anything special about the thumb today?
Just the collar and tie,
good, because it's a formal job that we do out here, idiots, very much so. In the final control, we have got Louise Pavide, ably assisted by Geraldine the Cheesecake, who has returned from a sojourn, various parts of South Africa. And on the other vehicle, no one is on the other vehicle, there are two small, dainty, antelope-like feet of Jamie Patterson wandering through the bush, being ably assisted by David and his lovely long brunette locks, and of course Herbert, who doesn't have quite so long locks, but he does have a very impressive moustache. Right, we are going to be driving around here, hopefully to find the lion cubs. Now, thank you very much to Karen for her update. There was a lioness at the pan, not sure what time, also a male leopard. The lioness came across this block. She's crossed the road just in front of us, heading straight back to where those cubs were yesterday. So we're going to go and have a look and see if we can find them there. If you're wondering what on earth you happen to be watching, you're watching a live safari. Dawn has just broken in the northeastern corner of South Africa. We're in the western fringes of the iconic Kruger National Park. That means, well, it's because we're live that it means you may talk to us, and indeed you are encouraged to do so with great vociferousness. Hashtag SafariLIVE if you're on Twitter, or questions at wildearth.tv if you'd like to ask us anything about what we're seeing here, what it is that we do out here, the animals that we're hopefully going to see, the birds, the trees, the soil, the landscape, the continent and the country. You're welcome, and it's great to have you with us. We're going to go and try and find some lion cubs. I'm just listening to some birds calling behind us there. I thought they were alarm calling. They're not. They're shouting at each other. Okay, let's go and see if we can spot these little cubbies. Now, there are a number of drainage lines that, or dry stream beds that crisscross this area. The first one is this one here called the Mulwati. Now, I was chatting to Herbert, who is a Shangaan man, and he is a brilliant tracker. And I said to him, what does Mulwati mean? He says, it means nothing, it's not a word. And it's quite interesting because I think a lot of the original names for rivers and trees and all sorts of things have been lost through the years because they weren't probably written down, and then when people who didn't speak Shangaan came into the area, i.e. the white man, we tended to sort of guess wildly at what they were called, and so the names have been lost. He said, what about it being called Mlwamati, Mlwamati, which means the fighting water. And so I thought that made much more sense. Mlwamati, as opposed to Mulwati, which means nothing at all. Right, let us drive through here, and it's not in this one. It was in the next one that the cubs were stationed. There are two fairly difficult approaches into the sighting, but we'll try them both. And she may have moved them, you know, those little cubs are starting to get just about mobile, and they might not be in exactly the same place. Very thick bush around there. You don't want to be wandering around too much on foot, because there is nothing quite as terrifying as a lioness trying to defend her. Magnolia, you're wondering how Rusty is today. Well, Rusty is this vehicle, everybody. Rusty is fine. We broke Rusty yesterday. I broke Rusty yesterday. I drove over a stump, and we discovered what it did was it broke the fan, which in turn shredded the fan belt, and that's why the steering stopped working and the engine heat went horribly up, and we had to cut off our drive half an hour early. Here are some impalas. Hello, impalas. Seen any lions? And we just Opal, the mechanic, just replaced the fan belt, and we're A for away. Lovely little herd of impala, but they're very skittish in the wind like this. This is a big cold front that's blown in from the southeast. It's apparently 17 degrees Celsius, which is 63 degrees Fahrenheit, if I'm not mistaken. And that's not too bad at all. It's not that cold, but the wind is much more icy than the ambient temperature. and it is consistent, which means that by the end of our 3-hour drive, you'll probably find that the temperature will be pretty much as it is now. We had the most magnificent day yesterday, still, warm, perfect, blue winter skies. And they're just eating bits of pieces of grass off the top of a little termite mound. Not a particularly impressive termite mound. Probably not the mound building termites. Probably something called odontotermes, which build those sort of very... What's the word I'm looking for, Bryan? Small mounds? I meant not very tall.
Wimpy mounds,
that's exactly what I meant, yes, yeah. Wimpy mounds. There it is, the wimpy odontotermes mound. You can hear the leaves rustling in the wind, those that are left on the trees. And a very subdued dawn chorus, one irritated Franklin gang. In the back. Righty, let us carry on. We're not too far from where that Leoness and her little babies were yesterday. I'm a little bit reticent to try and get Rusty in there again because, of course, that's what damaged her yesterday. But we'll try the easy entrance first before the hard one. Also, we have had another 2 or 3 vehicles go into the area and they've probably flattened a bit of a path. Just turning up the game drive radio. I'm just listening to Aubrey giving an update on where that male leopard went. He's going to look for the tracks around there. Probably most likely Mvula, who we saw earlier on. Our taxon getting mobile. And for those of you who are new, this is the game drive radio, and all the game drives in this area are in contact with each other, so we help each other to find animals. Taxon orbs, I've taken central. I'm going to go and try and relocate on those cubs. And the lioness tracks go from the pan across Gwarrie cut line into the block towards hyena. We'll just keep an eye out and see if she hasn't stopped somewhere around here. Very nice to see Mvula yesterday. Now, for those of you who don't know, Mvula, a male leopard who used to be around this area, he's kind of lost his territory because he's getting on a bit. And because he's getting on a bit, he's not really able anymore to defend a territory against a prime male like Tingana, who's also a bit bigger. And what was interesting is that he came back into this area. This is his traditional territory, but I haven't heard him calling. And that is an indication that it's perfectly normal that leopards, once they get a little bit older, they go nomadic. They don't mark territory anymore. Their days of breeding are over. They're kind of in retirement, if you like, for their last few years. So it'll be interesting to see up. If he doesn't sort of perhaps try and re-establish himself, if Tingana is operating more to the south and to the west, then he might try and re-establish himself here. But there's quite a lot of pressure from the north. Gijima, the skittish male leopard, is around there. And then to the east, of course, his son, Quarantine, but at the moment he seems to be fairly dominant over his son. Now, anywhere around here, Bryan, you might see little lion cubs. So if you do, please make sure to inform me. Then I shall depress the brake pedal and we will view them. So that's the second piece of the drainage line there that comes from Buffelshoek Dam. Now, what we're going to do is go into the block over here. See if we can't find him. Right, Jamie Patterson and her long antelope-like legs are out on walk. Let's go and find out what her plans are.
Well, our plans this morning, as James may or may not have mentioned, the weather is absolutely horrible this morning. The wind is howling in from the southwest, and the weather is cloudy and cool. And what that means is that we're going to be extra specially careful this morning on our bushwalk. We're going to be looking for the little things and the plants and the spiders and the snakes. We're going to be trying to dodge any of the bigger animals that might be out here. And that's because with this wind blowing, everything is particularly uncomfortable. We waited a little bit before we went out to start with. And that's because on cold, overcast mornings like this morning, you never know what might be around. Particularly, I'm thinking about hippo. The reason I say that is because, especially during this drought period, the hippos are desperately trying to get as much food as possible. So an overcast day like today, they're actually not going to go rushing back to water. They're still going to be around. So we're going to be staying in open areas. But before I show you what's in my hand, good morning, my name is Jamie, and I have Dave on camera with me, and of course Herbert, as always, out and about, scouting ahead and making sure that we don't get taken by surprise by anything. Right, let me reveal, the grand reveal, not all that exciting, but it is an interesting little example of a type of animal dung. It's a very special type of animal dung. This is fresh, this is slightly older, and if we break it apart, I'm going to do for you now. Oh, it's all blowing everywhere. Here you go. Grass within it. Now, our regular viewers will know precisely what this is and why it's so light in colour. Typically, an animal that feeds off grass, as this animal clearly does, would have a darker, almost black scat. Hold on. Okay, we're going to go compare it to one other. Let's go over here. Here we go. Here's some nice fresh stuff. Oh, actually, come here, Dave. I want to show you something. This is impala dung. And impala, typically, as you know, will be defecating in middens, or they just defecate wherever they happen to find themselves. But what's cool about this is we can tell which sex of animal this particular dung midden came from, and that's because of the wet patch around here. So that's urine, obviously. But the fact that the dung and the urine are basically on top of each other immediately tells us that a female stood here, the female impala. Because if it was a male, anatomically, as you may guess, anatomically, the urine would fall a little bit further away from the pile of dung. That's just how their physiology works. Right, so compare this colour, standard herbivore dung. Try and break it open. Okay, you just have a look at that for a second. Dave's laughing because I just used my teeth to break that open. I didn't necessarily want to show you that particular aspect of it. Here's some impala dung. See, it's a totally different colour to the dung we've picked up before. And that's because, it's also, interestingly enough, this is much larger than that, and this is a much smaller animal than that animal. Now, the explanation behind this is scrub hair. This is scrub hair dung. This is impala dung. And the reason the scrub hair's dung is totally different to that is because it's not a ruminant. And it actually does something very interesting called coprophagy. So what it'll do is it will eat, it'll defecate, it'll eat the defecation products straight as they emerge and redigest it. So basically, the food that they've eaten goes through a process sort of twice or three times before it is finally left to the elements. So that's why it's such a strange colour. It's a very, very different digestive type system, but the same, it's essentially the same diet. Now, impala wander around during the day, and I'm actually surprised there aren't more on this clearing. I think they probably spent the night here and then moved off somewhere more sheltered as it started to get lighter. Because animals have to, oh, I'm just going to blow backwards slightly. Animals quite like to sort of, they have a toss-up between being cold, but being safe, or being sheltered, but being stuck up on by something. And we don't want to be snuck up on by something either, so we're just going to keep walking along in nice open areas, peering around bushes and hoping not to find anything or take anything by surprise. Right, while we continue on our search for the littler things of bushwalk, let's go back to James and see if he's had any luck with those lion cubs.
We have not had any luck with the lion cubs just yet, everybody. We checked the bush under which they were lying yesterday. They're not there anymore, and I suspect they're inside this drainage region here. But we're not going to knock about off-road too much here. What we're going to do is go around to Buffelshoek Dam and check the area they were found yesterday morning. You cannot sort of get through. We're just going to, in fact, let's peep our heads over the top here. They have been up and down on this drainage line, and it's very easy to just stick our heads over the top here. And this is the direction in which that lioness was coming, and I suspect quite strongly that she would have walked back to this area and perhaps moved the cubs a little bit. She won't, I don't think, be taking them to kills yet. Hello, Allison, Oregon. You say, are the cubs old enough to be introduced to the pride yet? I think they are just about old enough. As far as I can work out, they are about 6 weeks old. Now, 6 weeks is normally when they would be introduced to the pride. And so, yeah, I mean, I think it's very soon that they will start to move with the pride. And in 3 months, they need to start eating meat. So, you know, it's between now and then that they will start moving with the pride. A little bit of angry call there from a grey go-away bird. Perhaps it couldn't see a lion. I can see a beefalo there, Bryan. Can you see it? Which indicates that lions are in short supply around here unless they are hiding very carefully. Now, a buffalo will kill the lion cub if it can find it. They will not tolerate the presence of lions and lion cubs. They are just getting up to start their grazing for the day. An increasingly great struggle to find good stuff to eat. One of them a little bit late getting out of bed. Like one or two members of our camp, Bryan. You know, struggle to get up. Okay, we're going to leave this block and we'll see if we can't go around to Buffelshoek Dam, around the other way. All right, Jamie has managed to find somewhere through the clouds that the sun's coming up. Let's go and have a look.
We're at the place.
The sun is making a brief appearance. I have to tell you, I say brief because I don't think that it's going to be visible for very long, given the way that the clouds are scudding across the sky. Don't you think that's a wonderful word? Scudding. Like a rowboat. Scudding across the sky. And hiding it from view. It's a beautiful sunrise, but with a thin wispy cloud, it's quite high cloud as well, it's not quite cirrus, but it's about one step below that. I think it's safe to say that, as always, the southern parts of our beautiful country are sending us their horrible weather. This is definitely coming up from the south. South Africa's climate is a very interesting one because we do actually get snow. We do actually get snow on the mountaintop. Sorry, I was completely taken by surprise there from a question from X-Ranger, or comment from X-Ranger, which is a really good one, which is basically, he's been listening to the wind on the dam cam, now probably listening to the winds through our microphones, and was wondering how the animals would react if we flew a kite. I have to tell you, X-Ranger, I think that they would... they'd probably react in exactly the same way as they did to the drone. The only thing is, there's no sound coming from a kite, unless it's one of those really scary ones that whistles and this flies really fast. Those sort of, I was going to say kite-shaped kites, but that's a bit tautologous, really. That would be an interesting one. I think that they would watch it with great curiosity. It's amazing what capacity the animals have out here to get used to something, and the natural curiosity that they all have. Right, so it's not just the hippos that are industrious on days like today. Come and have a look at these termites. They are very busy. Now, termites typically, of course, nocturnal little creatures. They like to work when it's cool and when there's no light on them. But an overcast day is the perfect day for harvesting things like these leaves. And a really nice contrast here between the different sizes of the different individuals. Some slightly smaller. Here's a slightly small one, so one of the workers. And then others with larger heads and much fiercer looking jaws. And they are industriously, as we can see here, making use of the dead leaves that have collected. And these leaves are what have been rustling around and making us all a bit nervous on foot. Oh goodness, this wind is it's quite cutting, I think. These guys appear to have fallen asleep. They're asleep on the job. Hello? Oh, somebody panicked a little bit. Hello? Are you awake here? No? Not so much. Now we've got the sleepy workers and then the actual productive ones. And they're busy taking chunks out of the leaves. We can see where their jaws have bitten through over here. And now they're all working together as a team over here to move this leaf into their termite mound. Interesting. Every now and again they do that funny little panicked motion. And I'm wondering if it's not in response to the wind. They're actually blowing in the wind. This one appears to be a bit confused. I think he's realized that we're here. No, he's not too bothered. What's up with you, buddy? Doing some strange things this morning. I don't know what that's all about. How cool is that? Look at the size of this guy's head. Why is he doing that? It's almost like he's trapped in a spider web. Herbert's gently whistling to me across quarantine clearings. I think he's telling me that he's found something. Yes, he's definitely found something. Oh, cool. Nice little view of our termites at work. I don't know what that one's doing, though. Why he's juddering backwards and forwards like that. I'm going to go see what Herbert's found. In the meantime, let's go see what James has found.
We have found a mountain of cloud there behind which the sun is attempting to peep up, and you can also see probably the incredible movement there of the clouds. They are moving at a great speed, Bryan. You see that?
I do.
It is very distressing. Mm. I feel very ominous. Maybe
slightly distressed.
Slightly distressed by the ominousness of it all. Mm. I will now show you the amazing picture I took, Bryan, of the sunrise. You will be sore amazed. Mm. There it is. Save. There we are, everybody. The world's greatest landscape photographer and his telephone.
Wonderful.
Thank you so much. Okay. Just thought I heard some rustling in the bushes here. It's in this little system that the cubs were seen yesterday. So let's be very slow. We did see a duiker running through here. It's difficult to tell the difference between a very stressed out duiker and just a sort of running duiker. So I wasn't able to tell whether the duiker had spotted a lion and her soon-to-be adult lion cubs. They're inescapably unterrifying when they're little, but that does change, doesn't it, Bryan? They get so very big. They grow up so quickly. There is a red-billed hornbill. Bridge in London, you ask a very valid, good question. You say, do lions live longer than other big cats because they live in a pride? Bridge, they do not. They, in fact, live a relatively short time, believe it or not, and that's simply because they are unable. They're not unable to do anything, but they don't. They don't live in a pride in order to make life easier. That's also absolute nonsense. Of course, they live in a pride to make life easier. They live in a pride largely to keep their cubs safe. We think that's the reason. It's not so much to find food, and so I don't know that it helps them as adults, actually, to be in a pride as far as longevity goes. So what I mean by that is that infanticide is obviously a huge issue amongst amongst lions, amongst all mammals, and it seems to be that through a roundabout way that the evolution of pride sociology has come about because of, I've got whacking in my ear from the game drive radio. Let me go again with that. Okay, so completely lost my train of thought. So the prides have evolved in order to look after the threat to cubs. They don't live any longer. In fact, they probably live less long than most leopards. So the average age of a male lion, maybe 10 or 11. Average age of a female, probably up to 12 or 13. So about 2 or 3 years younger than they than leopards on average. All right, let's go back to Jamie. She's got something horrid to show you.
Do indeed have... there's been a fight, there's been an argument. The thing that Herbert has located for you, it's my... Right, so those of you who are familiar with me, I have a deep, dark secret. I'm not afraid of snakes, and I'm not afraid of scorpions or spiders or any of those things. What I am a little bit reticent about, a little bit wary about, is things called centipedes. Luckily, Herbert has found some for me. So, there's two, actually, and both of them are hidden because the leaves are blowing, so I'm just going to uncover this very delicately. Right. Right, so that one's vanished. There it goes. There he goes. He's slithering about here. It's coming straight towards me. He's charging. I'm really not a centipede fan, I have to tell you, but they are incredible animals. Come on, buddy, I just want to... Here we go. Oh, that went well. Here we go. That's the back end of our centipede friend, with its multiple legs. Now, as you know, millipedes are wonderful. Centipedes, on the other hand, are venomous, very fast meat eaters. And they are actually, when they bite you, it is incredibly painful. Even a little one like that, they come right up to the size of my hand in terms of size. Now hold on, there's one more I'm going to show you here. He's actually starting to come out. I'm resisting the urge to step backwards. It's bad. I've got a serious thing about centipedes. I'd rather catch a snouted cobra. Here's the other one. Okay, there's our other little centipede dude. Both the same species. This one's a little bit tinier. Most proficient. Here he comes. He's coming through here. There he goes. Proficient centipede hunters. Oh, sorry, not centipede hunters. This is a centipede. Although they do hunt each other, just by the way. They can actually hunt and kill each other. They're also scorpion hunters, and they're the fascinating thing as ours disappears into the ground. Beautiful colours that he has. Oh, no, he's coming to find me. No, he's changed direction. Look at that. Blue legs, bright red backside. Everything about this creature says, please don't eat me, I'm going to hurt you in response. A really interesting little creature, but not one that I favour. So scorpions hunt centipedes, centipedes hunt scorpions, and depending on the size, the match could go absolutely either way. Now this little log is a veritable haven for little creatures. It's not just centipedes, and I've picked up one of them just to be able to show you. But before we go into that, where's our spider gone? Oh, spider's gone walkabout. There was a jumping spider here, but I think he jumped away in response to the... He's jumped away in response to the presence of the centipede. Can't decide if that's Herbert whistling at me or if it's the wind. But here's the centipede's cousin, a millipede that has gone dormant or attempted to be dormant. Watch out, Dave. Beware the centipedes that you are relatively close to. Here's a millipede, the completely innocent cousin of the somewhat more unpleasant centipede. They are perfectly okay to pick up. Lots, little bit more legs, and they are vegetarians. They're herbivores. Now, Paul, to talk about the more dangerous part of the millipoda family, you wanted to know whether or not it's true that if a centipede bites you, you've heard that certain species can actually paralyze you, and you thought that might be a myth. It's not a myth. I have heard something similar. Our species in this area are not quite so venomous. So there are some centipedes that have been fabled to paralyze people, and I think it's actually true, but we're talking more in the sort of Eastern Asian areas, possibly even towards Singapore and those sorts of places as well. You get very, very large species of centipedes with very, very powerful venom. Now, it might not work on if it's a bit Dave, not that we're going to test that theory, just because Dave is a healthy adult, fair-sized man. Small child, on the other hand, and that actually applies to these as well, they've got to be watched very, very carefully, because if they do get bitten by a centipede, they might have an extreme reaction in some way. The same applies to scorpion stings. So children and older people, any sort of more of the more vulnerable of the human beings, they actually have to be watched really, really carefully. And you have to keep an eye out for allergic reactions as well. One last thing before I go and find out what Herbert is whistling to me about, as the wind howls through here and finds any exposed piece of skin. Just look at this little chap. This is why looking under logs is such fun. Now he could be a piece of soil. But he's not a piece of soil. He's an insect. There he goes as he moves along. I'm not 100% sure which one he is, but he's really, really cleverly disguised himself, and he's covered himself in a layer of soil. So we're actually going to put him back to his most comfortable spot. You can see my fingers, just by the way, are turning blue. I've just noticed that. My fingers are blue. That's a comforting thought. Right, so I'm going to keep moving now because clearly I'm about to go into hypothermia mode. So while I pop our insect back, let's go back to James for an update.
No further tracks, I'm afraid. We checked the area where they were playing yesterday morning. They aren't there. I didn't see any tracks coming out of that block, so maybe they're still in there. We will go and have a look, but we're just going to go across to Buffelshoek Dam now and have a look and see what's there. There were tracks of Mvula heading this way, so maybe he'll be lying on the wall in the sun. He is not. But we'll go and look at the sun coming up anyway. Maybe he's lying below the wall in the sun, Bryan. Ooh, two hippos. Two little hippopotami. It's really quite a nice picture. Look at that. So, Sally, you asked a question all the way from Oregon. Thank you for it. Unfortunately, my brain was incapable of hearing it while I was talking at the same time. Let's go again with it. Ah, you say, if Mvula is nomadic, will Tingana leave him alone? It's not so much if he's nomadic, will he be left alone. It's much more a case of if he doesn't mark territory and cause trouble, then he will be left alone. So if he tries to mark territory, if he tries to create some kind of a niche for himself and calls, then the dominant male of the area is going to come and say, no, and that will be a problem for Mvula. At the moment, like I said, I don't think he's marking territory, I don't think he's calling. Look at that tiny little hippo. Shame. I mean, I do feel very sorry for the hippo. This is not a good time for them. Not a good time at all, because it is very, obviously this is not great habitat for hippo, much too shallow, but it's all they got at the moment. And there are two zebra coming down to have a drink, Bryan. We'll see them. And you can hear that wind blowing. There they come. They're a bit nervous. They're always nervous when they come down to drink, especially when they see us around. But they'll see what they do. And the mother hippo has turned to face them. She doesn't know what they want. They'll be slightly nervous of her, but not very. Hippo, very, very territorial over their water. Very, very afraid of having their water taken away from them. They need the water to stay safe and to stay out of trouble. See them, infinitely patient. The animals out here make human patients look pathetic. They are so careful about where they drink, where they eat, where they look, where they walk. And there's a huge amount of waiting that animals out here do in order to avoid being devoured by the predators. Stop, look, see? And the hippo mum's just looking at them. See the wind catching the surface of the water there. I'm just sort of sitting here thinking to myself what our next route should be. I think we'll go back around and just try that one place that we looked at yesterday for those lion cubs, and we'll move on and see what else we can find. But while we do that, let's just watch these zebra have their drink. See that? Constantly aware. That lioness could be anywhere around here. They know that. They instinctually know that there could be a predator here. Mvula could be around here somewhere. Although he wouldn't really pose a threat to a zebra that size. The hippo lifting her head out. She's giving them the slightly, I wouldn't say evil eye, but she's certainly having a look at them. Quite why they're so reticent. There might be something lurking in these bushes. Let's just wait here. Shamsun, you want to know the social hierarchy of a zebra herd. This is a rather poor example of what I'm going to tell you, because there are only two of them. The general makeup of things, Shamsun, is a stallion. He's got three mares, and those three mares will be attended by their offspring that are less than a year old. So the kinship group is what we call it, and they are led by a dominant stallion. He will get married a few times, have three or four mares, and they will have their youngsters, and when the youngsters are about a year old, they go off into sort of single-sex groups. No, they don't, sorry, the males go off into single-sex groups. I think these are probably two young stallions that are on their own. And then what happens with the fillies is that the stallions, or a stallion that wants to sort of take a mare, fights her father for her. And if he defeats her father, then the filly will go off with him. And if he gets defeated by her father, well then he has to go and do some more work in the gym so that he can fight again. It's quite an interesting situation that occurs. Be a rather good time lapse, wouldn't it, Bryan?
Mm.
And Shamsun, what's interesting is even a defeated male, a defeated zebra male stallion, his wives apparently stay faithful to him. So if he's defeated, his daughters will go off with a new one, but his wives will remain faithful to him, which I think is quite nice. Right, well, just, I think that's probably enough of that, zebra-wise. Let's go and see if we can find those little cubbies. All right, let's go back across to Jamie, get an update from her. We're going to turn around at the other end of the dam wall here, and then we'll keep up with you a bit later.
While we keep our fingers crossed for little baby lions, we've found a little baby gecko who is playing very hard to get. He's very, very shy, but you'll be able to see him, and he's absolutely beautiful. Now, geckos happen to be one of my favorite reptile species. They happen to be one of Kirsty's most feared reptile species, which is bizarre, because they're probably the most benign of all of the reptiles, and they eat mosquitoes and spiders and other things that perhaps people don't want in their places of sleeping. Also known as bedrooms, I suppose, would have been an easier way to phrase that. So a tiny little gecko, I think it might be a Turner's tubercle gecko. I haven't got too close to examine him because I was scared that he was going to run away from us all into this hole that was underneath the bark. So what we're doing on a day like today is Herbert is wandering around. He's picking up random pieces of bark and we're seeing what wonders they are hiding from us. And what a treasure trove this has proved to be. Apart from our little gecko, I'm going to shift this piece of dirt. Try not to frighten him so we can see his head. There we go. How's your... I messed that one up. And there he goes, disappearing into his hole. I'm not going to bug him any further. I don't want to stress him out. We've got our usual vast array of termites that have been very busy disposing of this piece of bark. Most of them are now retreating underground as the sun starts to emerge. There was a soldier here that I wanted to show you, but he's gone to ground and abandoned his fellow workers. No, he's gone completely. He's about triple the size of the average walker. Oh, you got him. Well done, Dave. Zooming in on our amazing termite species, including a much larger soldier. Now, Natasha, in Ontario, you wanted to know... Oh, here we go. Whether or not there are any insects that go into hiding during winter. And yes, most of our insect species either die off or go into a state of dormancy known as aestivation. Trying to give you a demonstration of this chap's... There we go. Oh! This chap's jaws. I'm not going to do it with my finger because I'm not a fool. I've never quite understood why James and Steph and Brent prefer to use their finger as a demonstration of the power of a soldier like this. I quite like my fingers unbitten. Here we go, look at that. Isn't that incredible? You can see the power of his jaws as he launches an attack. Oh, don't accidentally attack a worker there. Don't want that. Amazing. Now, if you find yourself ever stuck in a survival trying to survive and you're desperate for food, a termite is a very, very useful source of protein. So it is something that if you chose to, you could eat. Apparently they taste like peanut butter. I'm not going to test that theory now. I think they've done me absolutely no harm and I'm not in desperate need of any kind of survival feeding. I had breakfast this morning, so I'm not going to be eating termites. But you can actually feed off termites if you wish to. So a positive thing, and of course most of the mammals make use of these as a food source, a lot of them. Anything from the aardvarks and the pangolin, although pangolin are more ant-based eaters. But actually, any sort of predator, the mongoose will come and munch these if they find them. The the ringed reproductives that explode after rain. We get those, the algates, the reproductive termites. They get fed upon by tawny eagles, absolutely everything. Even I've even seen a leopard before wander up to where there's a whole mound of termites and actually go and lap up some of them and eat them. They're a very valuable source of protein. Mitch, on the opposite end of the spectrum, are there any insects that are harmful to mammals? Ticks are a big one. So, obviously, a tick infestation is going to, in some way, damage the health of the animal that they're sitting on. Look at this. Where did you come from? Aren't you absolutely incredible? Sorry, Mitch. We'll get back to dangerous insects in a moment, but there is something... There's actually two here, believe it or not, but let's start with the most obvious. Look at the color of this. Isn't this gorgeous? It is the most incredible teal color. That's a very girly way of explaining it. It's a blue-green color. Girls, of course, have a tendency to have a slightly larger range of color descriptions than boys tend to do, unless, of course, the boys are very artistic or cameramen. I'm sure Dave knows the word teal very well. One of the jewel bugs, and isn't it absolutely beautiful? I think it might actually no longer be alive. Let me just pick it up. So for the question about what insects hide away during winter or hibernate during winter, this one's actually died. Most of our insect life does die off. And it has got the most incredible colours. I'll try and tilt it slightly for you, so that you can see the scales shimmering on the back of it. It is too beautiful for words. I'm actually shivering, sorry, I'm trying to hold myself still, which is surprisingly tricky. Sorry, Dave.
All right. Keep this on the ground if you want.
Perhaps that's a better idea. Perhaps the ground might be more stable than I am at this point. Totally gorgeous. And then one last thing quickly, sorry. I know that James is waiting with a fascinating mammal, but we've got a fascinating insect for you. Just pop that back. Look at this. Guys, this is also an insect. Camouflaged, like it's wearing a spider web. This is an insect, not a piece of bark. It looks like a piece of bark covered in a spider web, but it's not. It's a bug. And this is what's so phenomenal about life out here. Right, let's go over to poor James, who's probably been waiting with his nyala ball for a while. Let's hope it's still there.
I'm afraid our nyala ball disappeared, everybody, but he is not the only resident of this particular area. I'm just going to try and get past this bushel over here. And behind it, you will see the buffalo that we saw from the other side of the drainage line earlier on. There are also some impala. The bush is quite thick in here. I don't see any tracks of the lions coming out onto the road here. Now I think that means that they're probably still inside the drainage, so it will be worth just sticking our heads in there to have a look just now. But for the moment, let's just enjoy the buffalo and impala and the sunrise. Oh, the impala have now disappeared as well. They're all going to go into as thick as bush as possible, trying to avoid being in the wind, which will make them very cold, Bryan. You can just see how the light is changing constantly as the clouds scud over the sun. Hello, Gabrielle, aged 8. Very nice to have you with us. Please tell us where you're from. It'd be very interesting to know where in the world you're watching us from. Gabrielle, you say, how long is the life of an impala? Gabrielle, about 12 years, we think. And if they're in captivity, they can probably live a little bit longer. But what you must understand, Gabrielle, of course, is that the animals out here do not die of old age. Normally, they are eaten by something when they get old. And so although they could potentially live, say, for 15 years, it's unlikely that they would live that long in this area. Because once they get a little bit weaker, they'll be eaten by something. like a lion or a leopard or a wild dog or a cheetah or a hyena. There's a red-billed oxpecker feeding already out and about. But if it's very nice, I always think on a winter, on a winter's morning, to be part of, to it's a good idea to be an oxpecker in the winter, because you can go and lie down on the animal that you're eating off, and of course then you feel warmth. It's like snuggling up to someone you know on a cold winter's morning. That's what the oxpeckers are doing, snuggling up to their buffalo friends. Not many things that would snuggle with the buffalo. I wouldn't snuggle with a buffalo, would you, Bryan?
No,
probably not.
No.
Best not to, I think.
Yeah.
Not with them horns. Mm.
And all the ticks.
And the ticks, yes. The ticks, of course, will climb all upon you. And then you too will require oxpeckers to remove them. Oh, Justin, you say, could a headbutt from a buffalo kill a person? Absolutely it could. That buffalo weighs upward of 600 to 700 kilograms. That's about 1,600 pounds. And they move at a speed that was probably quite close to, say, 45 miles an hour. So they're quick. And that kind of speed, clattering into a human being, would very quickly render them dead. Normally what they do, though, is they'll hook you with the horns, and that would normally cause some kind of severe stabbing trauma, and that's how they'll kill you. Now, that is not to say that they're overtly dangerous. They can be, certainly. You need to be careful of them if you're on foot, especially on a windy day like this. And that's why Jamie was mentioning that she's going to try and stay in the open. You don't want to come across these fellows on a blustery day like this where they don't know you're coming. Because if you give them a fright, then they can be quite nasty. All right, let's go forward and have a just peer into the bush here and see if we can't find some tracks. This is where we went in yesterday. It's very thick, so I'm not just going to go in and look there, because we did look from the other side. I think it's best to just have a look along the road first and see if there isn't some kind of evidence that they've come out. And if there isn't, then we will definitely go back in there and have a look-see. So we shall watch the road. They could easily come out. I think it's interesting that the buffalo are there, because buffalo, like I say, will not tolerate the presence of lions. The wind is blowing from the south onto them. So if the lions were around here, one would imagine that they could smell them. But maybe not. Maybe it's too gusty. I also have a suspicion that lions and leopards and possibly hyenas also don't actually smell much to the herbivores that they want to eat. I find it strange that they would have evolved a stink when it would so clearly give them away when they were on the hunt. That said, I think predators definitely do use the wind to their advantage. Sorry, I've spotted a buffalo standing up here. You see him there, Bryan? He's on a termite mound there. Let's just go a little bit along here. Shamsung, you say, are lions cooperative breeders? Or social breeders. I suppose to a certain extent they might be. Oh, communal feeders. Yes, absolutely, they are communal feeders. Just over there, Bryan, there's a buffalo on the termite mound. It's kind of where I was thinking the lions might be. Communal feeders, absolutely. They hunt together and then they feed together, but they don't feed in a particularly egalitarian or friendly manner. They normally fight with each other, much the same as hyenas. So unlike wild dogs, which really do feed with each other in a cooperative fashion, lions, the biggest, eats first. He's just finding the last bits of grass on top of the termite mound there. You can hear other lions in front of us grunting. Just go a little bit forward. Not lions, other buffalo in front of us grunting. No lion tracks at this stage. No. Oh, what they would be grunting at, I don't know. But let's just keep our eyes open down here. There they are. Not the lions, I'm afraid. More buffalo. They are all over this place. You see them through there, Bryan. We'll just have a quick look so I can show you where they are. I think these buffalo would have hemmed in. You know what? This is a herd of buffalo. It's a whole herd of them. It's not just a couple of bulls. So I think they would have hemmed in those lion cubs quite nicely. All right, let's head across to Jamie. She's got an update, apparently.
I don't really have an update for you so much as I'm now just climbing a tree. This massive marula that fell over as a result more of insect action than elephants. I don't think it was the elephants that pulled this over eventually. It was the termites. What I'm trying to do is imagine that I am a leopard. Now, I'm doing so cautiously because I have a fear that leopards don't seem to have, which is that this bark underneath this bark is going to be crawling with centipedes, having just seen two underneath marula bark. I'm a little bit nervous. I'm also ever so slightly nervous because this tree's been here for a while. Ever so slightly nervous that the termites might have been doing their job rather too efficiently and that any moment it might collapse and roll on top of me, at which point that would very much be the end of me. Seems to be okay so far, though. So a leopard manages to find a comfortable spot on the bark. Well, there we go. Well, while we are under a tree branch, a very happy birthday to Christopher in Arizona, who would like a happy birthday message from the Wild Earth team. So Christopher, from myself and the rest of us here at Wild Earth and on Safari Live. Herbert providing a happy birthday ululation, and Dave saying happy birthday as well. So happy birthday. I hope the tree climbing brings you much joy. I'm really hoping I won't fall off. Right, let's attempt the leopard stance. There's bark everywhere. Please don't let there be a centipede. Please don't let there be a centipede. Please don't let there be a centipede. So leopard somehow manages to make this look incredibly comfortable at this sort of pose. With legs dangling. Now I don't quite have the tail of a leopard. And I have to tell you, I don't know how they do it. Because whilst a marula tree bark is certainly not as thorny as something like a knobthorn, it certainly isn't smooth either. And there are parts of it digging into me that I don't appreciate. I could get used to it though. Perhaps this is how I'm going to spend the rest of my morning. Just waiting for the sun to rise above the horizon and the clouds, which doesn't look likely at this point, and perhaps hide out here. I'm going to move now because I'm slightly paranoid that the tree is going to roll over and collapse on me, which would be hugely unfortunate, because a tree this size, we were just trying to work out how old it would have been. It's absolutely massive. It weighs a good couple of tons and is probably well over 100 years old. Absolutely huge. Just imagine, whenever I sit and appreciate a tree like this, sort of imagine just what it must have seen and experienced. This tree might have been here when quarantine clearings was used to quarantine things like cattle. Certainly would have been here before Juma was part of the Sabi Sands, when back in the day when the boundary was actually, well, the gate into the Sabi Sands was around Cheetah Plains. And this was not game reserve, but something completely different. And it's safe to say that our marula, which has now reached the end of its life, was witness to all kinds of amazing things. How many times do you imagine that instead of a silly human being sitting on it, this marula tree actually had a leopard resting in its boughs? Mitch, while we are here, I never finished off your question. I'm trying to find my... I have to tell you, this is not as comfortable as I'm trying to make it look. It really isn't. There's all kinds of uncomfortable. Let's just swing this leg back over. Never finished off poor old Mitch's question, which was about insects. I'm going to be filthy when this bushwalk is over. Any kind of insects that might cause harm to animals. And we started off with ticks. There's something called a tsetse fly as well, which would have been around in this area before it was removed from this area many years ago through the introduction of DDTs, which is, as we now know, something that was phenomenally harmful, but was not known at the time, and they released a whole load of DDTs into this area, removing the risk of malaria, or at least reducing it immensely, as well as getting rid of all of the tsetse flies that pass on African sleeping sickness. They also bite horribly. There's things like horse flies. They don't cause sort of a permanent damage or cause the animal to die, but it is incredibly uncomfortable. They've got biting, sucking mouth parts that slice open the skin. Those of you with horses in South Africa might be more familiar with the horse sickness that can get passed on by flies as well. So it's more that the animals are vectors of disease rather than hugely harmful themselves. So the plasmids and the bacteria, the viruses, those are passed on by a lot of the different insect species out here. Malaria is not something that's contracted. You get human malaria and you get animal malaria. We don't have much in the way of animal malaria out here. And there's no indication at the moment that some of the other nastier diseases, like rabies, get transmitted by things like insects. That's direct salival or blood contact. But those are the insects. It's more because they're vectors of disease than anything else. Right, how graceful does one suppose this descent is going to be? Dave, what are we going to? Are we going to score it? Yes. We're going to score it. Okay, let's try and do this without getting hooked. Let's make sure that all the cables are where they should be before I break something. Hopefully not a leg either. Ha. Huh. Dave gave me a 9. Lou gave me a 10 out of 10. Now, I'm not quite sure what Dave took marks off for, and I'm deeply insulted, so while I question him on why that might be, let's go back to James for an update.
I'm afraid, everybody, we don't really have an update. We did see that herd of buffalo. We turned around and we came back through here. Now, this is where the lion cubs were yesterday. And so I think what we're probably going to do is just stick our noses into where they were seen yesterday. And then if we don't find them exactly where they were, then we'll move on. Because there have been a lot of beefies around here, and I haven't seen their tracks crossing the road, so I'm wondering if they aren't perhaps still in there. So let's just put our noses in here. I'm not going to go walking in here given the number of buffalo, the wind and the potential for a lioness, so we'll just stick our noses into where we were yesterday and see what we can come up with. It's not thick. I mean, you can see the bush around us is not thick, but the elephants have pushed so many trees over this place that getting into and out of these areas is a little bit difficult. There's a giraffe there now, which makes me think that there are definitely no lions around here. That's very interesting. It's the same giraffe we saw yesterday. We'll forge ahead briefly. Canada Keith, you want to know how many trees a year die due to elephant abuse? Canada Keith, I couldn't begin to give you an answer. Thousands, probably, but fewer than you think, Canada Keith, because we know that very few trees actually die from elephants. Many get pushed over, like this one here on our right-hand side, but it's not dead. It's just lying down, and it is now growing from another angle. So while many, many, probably almost millions of trees become damaged by elephants every year, very few of them actually die. The noticeable exception would be the knobthorn tree. Knobthorn trees tend to be debarked quite badly by elephants, and then they tend to die. But the rest of them often survive. So while it's impossible to say how many exactly they kill, I think you'll find the proportion of trees that they push over the die is probably, I'm going to guess at around only 10%. So not that many. There's the giraffe in front of us. Now, giraffe are normally very good at spotting lions, aren't they? And that giraffe don't look like he's in a bit much of a panic. And this is where the lions were. So I think we're going to give up on our lion cub chase this morning, everyone. I've no doubt we'll see them again. Let's just enjoy our giraffe here for a little while. And then we'll go down. Now, there are reports of two mating lions not too far from the old hyena den. So we might go along there. Look how the light's opened up onto his face. Isn't that nice? I just think that's beautiful. Oh, wow. And look at the waving leaves there. Now, word has it that Karula has gone off towards Hoffman's, which is to the south of the reserve, which is a bit sad. But we might be lucky with something else in the way of cubs. I really feel like, you know, a day like today is a good cub day. Maybe we shall be lucky. Look at his beautiful colours. He's in really good nick. He's a bull in his prime. He's kind of, I mean, he's on the oldish side, I suppose, but he's, you can see his skin is in fantastic condition. And many of these giraffes get skin lesions and diseases caused by various different things. And those injuries and things that they get are not, in fact, detrimental to their health, but they're a very good way of aging a giraffe. And the cloud is really scudding overhead there. That's exactly what I was talking about there. That's quite a good way of aging them. So I think that they probably lived around 16 to 18 years out here. This chap's probably about 12. You can see the calcification, the bumps all over the top of his head. Now he is walking exactly where the lions were yesterday. And he doesn't, if he saw them, for example, if he saw the cubs, he'd stop immediately and he'd stare down at the ground. If he saw the lioness, same thing. But he's just wandering gently through there, trying to find some delicious leaves to feed on. Right, so our last action here is going to be to just pop our heads over the top of the drainage line. I also think, given the time of the day, it's highly likely that if there were lion cubs around here, they'd be playing round about now, and we'd hear them. They'd be going, wow, 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 wow. Let's just look here. You see, these beefies have come right through here. So the chances of the cubbies still being here, very, very small. Do one last look through here. Bryan, watch out there. Do not become impaled upon that stick. Oh, Bryan, that's a lovely shot. Let's just have a listen quietly here. I think this is a rather wonderful area, and I think I might suggest putting a road along the fringe of this drainage. It's beautiful. Michael, you want to know at what age those cubs are going to be courageous enough to come and approach the vehicle. They won't ever approach the vehicle in the same way that hyenas do. They don't become quite that inquisitive. They might just completely ignore it, though. So, I mean, I've had lion cubs underneath the car before. But that's because they're playing with each other and stalking each other and using the vehicle for cover. They don't really come off and sort of bite off the oil caps like the hyenas do. And we've had certainly one or two of those hyenas leap up onto the bonnet and look, not onto it, but, you know, sort of put their feet up and look over the top. It's highly unlikely the lions would do that. You don't want the lions to do that because, of course, if they do that when they're older, well, it's just utterly terrifying, basically, and we don't want that. But luckily, they don't seem to have that level of curiousness, and leopards even less so. So leopards will certainly come and totally ignore the vehicle. They'll walk underneath it and use it as cover, but they don't seem to find the fascination with it that the hyenas do. All right, let's get out of here, see if we can't go and find that male and female lion. What a pity. I was rather hoping to see some lion cubs today, Bryan.
Me too.
Yes. Oh well. No harm done. I mean, I would be tempted to go looking through there, but the giraffes just walked through there, and I really don't think that he's, I don't think he's blind. So what I think they've probably done is move off deeper into the system, where you cannot get vehicles. Probably not too far from where they were yesterday, although we did look there, and they're not there. So that's it for the lion hunt. Well, for this particular lion hunt. No further tracks of Mbula have popped out. Taxon and Aubrey are looking around hard for them. And interestingly, I've just had an update from Cheetah Plains. This is a vicious, vicious plant. And the update from Cheetah Plains seems to be that Inkanyeni has lost one of her cubs. Now, she had two cubs. I don't know that, did we? Yeah, we did see them. Sam saw them on drive once, and she's lost one of them. And Brent also saw them up there, I think. So that's a bit sad. It's not unusual. I mean, as our regular viewers will know, we talk constantly about the risks associated with the young cubs. And that's interesting because I think they were almost 6 months old. No, they were more. They're probably almost 8 months old. So, you know, even though they got past what is seemingly the most difficult part of their lives, they didn't make it, which is very sad. All right, let's go get an update from Jamie. We'll make our way out of here and we'll see you hopefully with some mating lions very shortly.
Okie dokie. So while James goes searching for the mating lions, now I know that you guys have just got that sad news about Inkanyeni's cub. I did know about it about 2 days ago, but it wasn't confirmed, so I didn't want to say anything until we found out. But really very sad, and I'm so disappointed that she has not managed to keep all of her cubs. It's just one of those devastating things about getting attached to the leopards that we know in this area. And I know that Shanae is particularly very, very upset about that news since they were her favourite leopards. But we're going to move on for John, and we're going to talk about the bush pharmacy because Herbert's just been giving us some really amazing information. We're going to start, actually, with this tree, the monkey pod, a senna. Now, as you can see, it's looking a little bit the worse for the wear. Such is life in the middle of winter and the dry season, but we've got 6 remaining leaves as Jamie shivers away, try not to touch anything. So Herbert tells me something I had no idea, that they'll eat the seeds are quite nutritious from this plant and they're not toxic in any way, but interestingly on a sort of pharmaceutical bent, if you dig down into the root system, you will be able to find the roots are actually used in fertility, to aid in fertility. So they basically make a potion and they combine that with the Gwarrie bushes to create this particular potion. And you'll find with Gwarrie bushes, they're used as a base almost, as a number of different medications. Now it's easy for us with our westernized views to discount such things, but we'd actually be foolish to do so. Because as you know, a lot of the medicines that we have discovered as human beings and are actually derived from the chemical properties of the plants. So lots of things do actually have medicinal uses. The silver clusterleaf, for example, that are all over this place. And this is because this area is disturbed. It's not a natural clearing. It is a clearing that's been created over time That's one of the reasons why we've got so many silver cluster leaves. But with their high tannin count, Herbert tells me, marvellous for upset stomachs. So if you eat too many termites, and that does actually, but believe it or not, we spoke about the survival, that will give you an upset stomach if you eat too many. Eat lots of leaves. Here's a gall, by the way, just since we're here and I've spotted it. This growth in the plant is the plant itself, and it's been caused by a wasp injecting her larva into the plant itself. So she lays her eggs in there, and she also fiddles with the growth hormone of the plant to create an artificial casing. Not an artificial, it's entirely natural. But to create a casing for her babies, and it's a species-specific wasp to the silver cluster leaf. So another little amazing aspect. But that's not what we're talking about at the moment. We're talking about pharmacies. So Herbert tells me that he thinks that a lot of these marulas were actually deliberately planted in this area. And they did that because marulas produce berries, and they also have a tremendous medicinal importance. So we've got a nice combination here of the marula tree, which we did know about before. Marula tree, if you find yourself with itchy skin, let's say you've encountered a hairy caterpillar, one of the caterpillars that has those very itchy, fine hairs. So what you want to do then is you want to go and you want to peel away, cut away at the bark, which obviously I'm not going to do to this magnificent marula, but you want to get into the cambium layer beneath the hard bark layer. You want to find that ready bark that is underneath, strip it away, and rub it on your skin. Oh, here's another amazing, here's the best part of what Herbert told me. This is not quite medicinal, but it is a cultural belief. So we've spoken before about the value of marula trees in rituals concerning whether or not you want to have a boy or a girl when you are pregnant. And because marula trees are dioecious, which means they're either a male or a female, you can actually sleep with the twigs or drink a potion of either the female part or the male tree, or the female tree, depending on whether you want a boy and a girl. Now here's the best part of the story. Now, only the female trees produce fruit. That's how you know that they're a female tree. It makes total sense. Now, obviously some trees are valued for their fruit and you don't really want a male tree. So what Herbert tells me, you know the giant land snails that we get out here? The giant land snails have both the male and the female reproductive parts because they don't often see each other. So when they mate, they want to try and they fertilize each other. It's a really clever way of making sure that they make the most of encounters in order to reproduce. If you want to change the sex of the tree from a male to a female, you take a giant land snail shell, you drill a hole in it, you tie it up with a piece of string, and then you tie that piece of string to the tree. How incredible is that? It's such a logical, in a way, it obviously doesn't work, you can't change the fundamental nature of the tree, but it makes such a logical sort of progression from the snail that is the hermaphrodite, it's not a hermaphrodite, but it's seen as a hermaphrodite, to then change the sex of the tree. It's absolutely phenomenal. Really, really cool. I've never heard that story before, and Herbert is just a wealth of information about that sort of thing. Just have a look at the bark here, because I want to aid you in your tree identification. This is a marula tree. We're going to carry on with our pharmacy in a moment, but just have a look at it. It looks to me, the way I always feel about marula trees, as though somebody's taken a bit of an ice cream scoop to the bark, which is what makes these lovely holes here. So you've got these gaps, and then you've got the layers of the bark. They're like scales. But I always feel as though it looks as though it's... Somebody once described it as somebody hitting golf balls at a tree. It's not really like that. It's like somebody's taken an ice cream scoop to it. And you can see it really, really clearly on that marula tree at the back. There we go. So you can see it sort of looks a bit scooped. But before we send you back across to James, one last thing, because I want to just help with your tree identification. Let's just go across to our lovely apple leaf, which is right next door. Also an incredibly valuable tree. The bark is similar, but much smoother and a little bit lighter in color. So that's what we're looking for in terms of identifying the different trees. So we have the same thing when we identify birds. It's a general impression of size and shape. And the bark, especially when there's no leaves, is a really nice indicator about what you're looking at. Herbert told me something about the bark, but he's told me so much now I've actually forgotten. And he's gone. Oh no! I was going to ask him to remind me what this was used for. Oh, upset stomach. I remember now. He says it absolutely works, and I believe him, because, as I said, there are medicinal properties and chemicals to these trees. Strip away the bark, like we talked about with the marula, get to the cambium layer, soak it in water, and then drink it. If you have an upset stomach, Herbert says he's tried it, and it works very, very well. So none of that Imodium for us out here in the bush. You find yourself in desperate need, an apple leaf will sort you out. I'm going to go and find Herbert again and get him to tell me more amazing things like tying land snails to trees. While I do that, let's go back to James for an update.
We have found many impala, everybody. Not arrived where the lions were supposed to be just yet, so let's just enjoy these rather splendid antelope sitting in the morning sun. Very pretty they are. Highly underrated. You can just still hear the fact that there's almost no sound of birdsong. It's still just the rushing of the wind. Well, those lions are not supposed to be too far from here. So we'll just look at these impala for a little while, and then we'll go towards the lions and see what we can see there. Kathy, you want to know, this is I'm really being hit with some pretty difficult questions today. You want to know if impala have peristalsis. Kathy, I'm assuming you're talking about peristalsis when they're digesting their food. Peristalsis, for those of you who don't know, everybody, is the movement of the gut. So the muscular movement of the gut. So if you imagine squeezing toothpaste out of a toothbrush, out of a toothpaste tube, that kind of motion of squeezing the walls of the toothpaste tube and getting the toothpaste out of it is much the same as your intestine does in order to move the food through it. And you say, do impala have the same thing, Kathy? Absolutely they have the same thing. Otherwise they wouldn't be able to get the stuff through the gut. It'll happen in the esophagus. And the esophagus, of course, The esophagus, of course, between the mouth and the stomach. And there's peristalsis to get that food into the stomach. And then in the case of all the ruminants, like the impala and the giraffe and the buffalo and all the antelope, they have reverse peristalsis, where the food is regurgitated up into the mouth again. And you can actually see that process taking place. It's quite amusing to watch when animals are ruminating. And then the other part of the body that it happens in will be the small intestine. And probably the large intestine, but definitely the small intestine, which is the long bit of intestine that you have in your body. I'm not sure what it is in a human being, but it's a lot. It's many, 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 many meters of intestine, and all through your intestines there will be peristalsic pulses of muscle that will move the food through as it is digested and the nutrients are absorbed. Very, very beautiful in this light, I must say. Right, from peristalsis, let's see if we can find these lions. They should be just up the road here. Our signal might get a little dodgy here, but it should be right and rusty. Wendy, it would definitely be a nightmare. More impala, they're looking pretty relaxed, not greatly panicked by life. It's good for them, not for us. And this is where we started our drive, everyone. We were looking at this very large juggleberry tree, which I'll have to climb at some stage. There's often a giant eagle owl in there as well. Now, for the last little while, every day between drives, we've driven up here, a few of us, and we've helped Connor. Well, we haven't helped him, we've watched him and done a bit of assisting with a new drone. And it's a fixed-wing drone, which means it's basically a remote-controlled aeroplane. It's not a quadcopter, it's not one of those four-propellered things that make loud buzzing noises. And it's been really interesting, and some great tests were done. We managed to get a signal out of it. We managed to get it to shoot a very nice little sequence of us standing on the ground here. So that was really exciting. So we're hoping one day, not too distant future, we'll be able to introduce that. And the advantage of it over that quadcopter drone that we used was that it's just so much more quiet. I'm afraid I missed that, Louise. Not going to give it to me again. Ah, Jamie has got an arachnid to show you. Ugh.
Ugh, indeed. A mystery thing. A mystery. I don't think arachnid, to be 100% honest with you. It was my initial thought, but it doesn't actually look as though. I don't know what this is. I just know that it is absolutely incredibly camouflaged, and it kind of looks, it's camouflaged kind of look like a bird dropping. Let me find myself another stick or blade of grass so that we can have a closer examination and that you can get an idea of a sense of scale. Try and hold it still because I'm shivery. There you go, our blade of grass to give you a rough idea. It does look like a tick initially. But what isn't tick-like at all about it is lack of biting mouth parts. So that's the antenna of this little insect. I think it's living off whatever this tree sap provision is like. That's really very cool, and I think it would work perfectly in terms of hiding away in lichen on trees, or, in this case, hiding as a bird dropping. A really, really clever little creature. And speaking of bird droppings, just to move on, something, oh goodness, I'm stuck in monkey pods. Something was living in this tree, and it no longer is living in this tree. Peering up into it just to make sure it's not about to deposit something else on my head. Doesn't look like it's going to, but the reason I say that is just because we've got a number of droppings here from where it's perched, and that's obviously a favourite perch of its, because this has not all come from one defecation. This has come from several. And of course, birds being birds, the urea is solid, and they don't urinate. They excrete their urea as the white stuff that accompanies the dung. And you can see there's lots and lots and lots of them around here. As well as the shell of some kind of egg, probably a reptile egg, hard to tell at this stage. But there's no nest looking up. My suspicion, I don't know exactly, but my suspicion is that this might have been one of our little owl species, perhaps something like a pearl-spotted or a scops owl, just because I know that they love these trees and they have preferred perches. That's why I'm not breaking it open with my finger. This is surprisingly tricky. I don't really want to touch it if it is a bird of prey. Break it open and see what it is. No, can't have been an owl. Look at that. And just a moment of discovery here. That to me doesn't look like a scat. It looks like a bird of prey, a bird of that eats possibly plant material. Still a closer examination. Where's my other piece of bark that I was using? Let me use that. Let's have a closer look. Hmm. something that eats insects. There's exoskeletons in there. Look really, really closely and you'll be able to see it. So it could be one of our smaller owl species, actually. There's exoskeletons, there's old termites, and various other arthropods. Very interesting. Curious. A mystery, I think, that we will probably never know the answer to. And speaking of solving mysteries and finding things out, let's find out how James's lion search is going.
We're just trying to find where those lions were. Apparently they were in here, just to the south of the boundary. But I can't see anything. Copy that. Confirm, sorry, orbs, confirm at least text, confirm south of the firebreak. Yeah, I've got absolutely no idea here. Apparently there was a branch on the road here and the lions were just close by. Well, I haven't seen them. Just over here. There you go, copy, thanks. Let's just keep a look into the middle here. Now, they are mating lions, of course, which means they will move. They won't be in one place for any length of time. So we might just have to stop and have a listen to see if we can hear the growling. Because they do growl or squeak, yes. In the case of this Birmingham male who's been trying to mate over the last little while, here are the tracks of the vehicle going into the block here. So they're obviously quite close by here. Let's stick our noses in here and then we'll turn off the car and have a listen. Can't hear anything. No, we've got nothing in here. Ephraim is coming up behind us to see if he can help. I suspect quite strongly that they've gone down into the drainage. Here comes Ephraim. And the one chom. Yeah. Okay.
Thank you.
There goes it from everybody. If they've gone down the drainage line here, there's no chance of us seeing them. It's too thick. Go ahead, Tex. Ah, I come on in chom. We come and go on the Amova. I east. I'm sure Tingene Langovin. I'm just telling Tex that I think that they've gone into the drainage line. Let's go and have a look at the hyena den. We were going to try and go there yesterday, and we didn't, so maybe we'll try it now. I'm just going to keep an eye on Ephraim behind us. He'll call us if he finds the lions. So I think those lions, unfortunately, and you're in Alabama and you were hoping to go off to the hyena den. Well, there we go. We're on our way there now. And might be worth just having a quick look here. I don't know how many of you have noticed, but that fairly large piece of earth moving equipment has been stranded here for the last 2 or 3 weeks. Well, it's now being rescued, everybody. You'll be most relieved. You can see it's now smiling. It was looking very depressed and sad over the last little while. You can see the light is changing all the time. It's amazing to me. It's kind of goes grey and horrible, and then the cloud breaks and it turns into this amazingly sort of dappled lit landscape, and the golds of the winter are now fading to kind of much more pale yellows and I suppose bronzes, if you like. But it's all changing rather fast. Watch your head there, everybody. And these winds will get rid of the last remaining leaves on the trees. And come September time, this place will look like a couple of sticks. And it's very harsh if you're not used to it. It's very harsh if you haven't seen it before. But if you're used to it, it's just very beautiful. It's very subtle colors that you get at that time of the year before the explosion of life. Go ahead. We've just got Aubrey calling me. Go ahead, Orbs. Yeah, I bet if I'm in the anger. He's asking where he can see human tracks and wondering where Herbert is. Antivi gas, I'm sure jige jige leka quarantine mar antivi. Alright, we're not too far from the hyena den. Alright, Jamie has managed to find, and this time it really is an arachnid, so let's go and have a look there.
Oh, this is actually an arachnid this time around. It is a spider, and if we have a close look at it, it's going to tell us everything we need to know about this particular chap. Oh, I'm going to try and shuffle forward. So everything in this spider's anatomy, its powerful legs, its incredible camouflage, because obviously it is a bark spider. It hides in bark, and it is perfectly camouflaged to that means and ends. It's got the sort of the light-coloured patches and the dark-coloured patches, all of which serve to break up its outline and keep it incredibly hidden. Now, not only do we know that, we also know this is an active hunter. You can tell what spiders are designed to spin webs. There he goes, to spin webs. And there he goes, into a hole there. To spin webs and then use those as a catchment area, and which ones are actually geared towards hunting. Things like our jumping spiders. Think about probably the best web hunter of them all, the best known web hunter, the golden orb spiders, those massive, massive spiders that we see during summer. And they've got these huge webs that they create, and they catch insects that fly into them. They're clearly web hunters. They've got long, thin legs. They're not geared towards really rapid movement because they don't need to be. Once something's stuck in their web, they've got all the time in the world to go shuffling after it. But this little guy and the jumping spiders that we often find, slightly more compact legs, thicker legs in proportion to their body, and that provides for the really powerful forward motion that they need to do because they're active hunters. You see the same thing with the baboon spiders. Just speaking of arachnids and spiders, here is a spider webbing, and this would most likely have been for egg sacs more than anything else. I don't necessarily think that it is in any way meant to catch anything. It's a spider's home. In this case, I think an egg spider. I think that is the remains of the spider that created this little shelter. Might have been a place to lay eggs, it might also just have been home for the end of a day, the end of a hunting day, go and sort of weave themselves a little sack somewhere to keep nice and safe, hidden in the bark. On a sort of an active foraging kind of note, this whole place has got all kinds of amazing things. There we go, look at this. There, that's what I was standing in, just by the way. There you go. Spike thorn. No, called spike thorns because they spike thorn you. I just want to show you something quickly. Something that Herbert pointed out to us. Well, earlier on, I was questioning Dave on a very mysterious pile of dung that he... Oh, actually, before I step any further, we've got even further evidence here. Something has been having a marvelous time eating the monkey pods. And I'm not going to tell you what it is, and the reason I'm not going to tell you what it is because James has got an extraordinary bird for you.
An extraordinary bird it is, everybody. That there is a stunning, stunning example of a juvenile martial eagle. Now, juvenile don't mean that it's small. Juvenile simply means that it hasn't quite attained its adult plumage yet. So it's probably about 2 years old and about to get the adult plumage. To give you an idea of its size, it is just shy of 3 feet tall, top to bottom, and it weighs about 9 pounds. Here it goes. Well, that's quite heavy for a bird. Wingspan, if you can believe it, is 2.5 meters long. Now, 2.5 meters in feet is, 2.5 feet is about, 2.5 meters is about 8 feet. So it's a massive, massive bird. And the female's bigger than the males by almost 25%. And they can weigh up to 5 kilograms, which is about 11. It's 11 pounds. Isn't he great? His diet is largely made up of, well, it'll eat just about anything, really, that it can catch. But their real favorite is to eat rock monitor or tree monitor lizards, huge lizards. And also, I've seen two juveniles roughly that age, I've seen them whack a baby impala. And what they do is they'll kill something like that and they won't fly away with it, it's too heavy. They'll devour it on the ground. He's an intimidating looking fellow with that grey sky behind him, isn't he? Gee, that's fantastic. Look at the clouds moving behind him, everybody, and see him balancing there. It's not that easy for him to stand still as the gusts come through. And difficult for a bird like that to fly, you know, in this type of weather. I've seen one battalier this morning flying around. They're, of course, extremely efficient flyers, much more so than just about any other bird. But a bird like this really does need some heat to come off the ground and float gently in the sky. Otherwise he's just going to sit there lurking slightly miserably. I always think it's quite interesting that birds don't, you know, we tend to think of nests as being places of comfort. Look at him turning around, that rather vicious looking face. We think of them as being places of comfort. And that's why we use the term nesting when we talk about people buying homes. Ah, well, they've started to nest, you say. But nests are almost universally only for breeding. And they're not very comfortable. So a bird like that is actually much more comfortable standing out in the open. They don't feel the elements like we do. They don't feel the need to get inside. Oh, he's either going to relieve himself or fly away. I think that's just fantastic. So that's by far the biggest eagle that we get here. It's by far the biggest eagle in Africa. It's not quite the same size as a harpy eagle, which I believe is the world's biggest eagle and can be found in the forests of Southeast Asia. And again, I've mentioned in the last two drives I've taken that incredible series, The Hunt. And if you ever want to see a harpy eagle hunting, go and check out that series. It's an unbelievable thing to see. Right, that's the martial eagle. And martial spelt in the same way that you'd spell martial as in military, M-A-R-T-I-A-L, as opposed to martial as in somebody who might marshal you around the place. Or a U.S. Marshal, for example. Elaine, you want to know if a martial eagle is larger than a bald eagle? I know the bald eagle's pretty big. I think they're probably about the same size. This one might be slightly larger. But I don't know the size specifications of the bald eagle. But are roughly the same size. I mean, he's substantially larger than our fish eagle. And the fish eagle out here is very closely related to your bald eagle. But definitely smaller. He's a very impressive fellow. Righty, on we go. We're still in search of the hyena den. Haven't managed to make it there yet. Hello, Lucy. You say, is it common for it to be windy during the winter months? Lucy, it's not uncommon, but it's only when these fronts come through. So what happens is that basically the weather pattern works that these weather systems slam into the Cape, you've heard of Cape Town. They slam into that area, they move up the coast and then into the interior, they drop snow on the escarpment, and normally by the time they reach the mountains there, they've kind of dissipated and we don't get them. And then the really bad ones, like this one, bad is a relative term, of course, the really sort of strong ones will come through this area, and they come in from the southeast like this, and that's when we get these windy conditions. So normally, no, it's not windy. I'd say during the summer months, you know, we can go often 3 months and have, you know, maybe a week of cloud and wind. And the west is just perfect, perfect conditions. Here's an interesting nest that I think was probably an attempt by a weaver or a waxbill. It was probably a waxbill, you know, that attempted to build that little nest there. No one else there, and certainly any eggy that was in there in this wind would fall to the ground. All over the place we find little nests of birds that have absconded after they've bred during the summertime, and much of the time got absolutely no idea what made them. Steph and I both have found the same nest at different occasions, a nest about sort of a meter and a half off the ground, that's about 4 feet, a sort of substantial grass nest that looks like it could hold something the size of a pigeon, and no idea what makes it. Could be a green pigeon, I suppose. Let's check that. Hold on, everybody. Move your dentures out. Hold them in your hand. You can put them back just now. Hello, Anna. Nice question from you about whether or not we see new animals every day. There's a white crested helmet shrike, Bryan. Do see it? There's a flock of them. There's a whole flock of different birds here. There's a flock of white helmet shrikes there. That's what you're looking at there, white crested helmet shrike. And there's some babblers knocking through here. Isn't he lovely? What a beautiful bird. Anna? Yes and no. In terms of mammals, no, we don't see new mammals every day. I think we probably see many of the same ones every day. Yes, of course, there are elephants that migrate into this area and then disappear again. There are impala that might be different every so often. Wildebeest might come and go. Buffalo herds, the same. But in terms of mammals and different mammal species, no, we normally see the same kinds of things just about every day. But there are many of them. But if you want to look for different animals and discover new animals that you haven't seen, well, then you've got to go down to the level of the invertebrate. So you've got to be looking at insects and arachnids and millipedes and crustaceans and centipedes and that sort of thing. Then you will find things quite often that have not been seen before. But the mammals we know pretty well. The birds we know pretty well. A total bird list in an area like this of probably, at the outside maximum, of around 300. I saw a flash of yellow in there, but I can't see what it was. All righty. Let's turn down here onto a slightly smoother road. Ah, Justin, you want to know the smallest bird we get on the reserve is. The smallest bird, as far as I'm aware, is the grey penduline tit. The grey penduline tit is a tiny little thing. I'll show you a picture of it now. It is about that big. 2 inches. 2 and a bit inches long. So not quite as small as the bumblebee hummingbird, which is the world's smallest bird that's found in South America. But not much bigger. Let me show you a quick picture of the grey penduline tit. T for tit. 328. There we are. Oh, not wrong tits. It's probably under P for penduline tit. Must be. Yeah, hang on 1 second. Sorry about that. P. There we go. 364, Bryan. How very embarrassing, wouldn't you say? Yes. There's the grey penduline tit there. He's quite a pretty bird. And they live in little flocks, and they make the most amazing, amazing nests. They're made, they almost look like they've been made of cotton wool, and they've got a very secretive entrance that folds in a complicated way, which means that if it looks like an entrance, but it's a fake entrance. And so birds such as, or not birds, but predators like snakes, won't be able to find a way into the nest. It's really very clever. And that is the grey penduline tit. Very nice. On we go, Bryan.
On we go.
To the hyena den, where there'd better be some hyenas, or I shall be very cross. I might be tempted to walk up to the den and fish them out. Tell them to play with us. Ah, Jamie has yet another arachnid to show you.
I hope that the cub is out as well on this cold and windy day. We found something really cool. I say we, Herbert has found something really cool. I'm just going to wave hello to the people that are driving past and looking at us like we're completely mad. And then I'm going to show you the amazing arachnid that Herbert found us. So James was speaking about how we discover new, on bushwalk, we discover new things all the time. This is, I have never seen a scorpion this color. And what's really cool about it is he's giving us a perfect, somewhat shy demonstration of that flattened carapace that the scorpions have. So that laterally flattened shape that allows them to do things like this one is doing. This scorpion you can't really see because he's hiding in the crack of the bark, but he is in there. And he is bright, almost luminous green. Absolutely marvellous. He's hidden away in this crack of this bark. He's playing hard to get, and it's a species that I have never seen before. An absolutely remarkable little sort of evolutionary thing that has, I don't know why, it's favoured a bright green scorpion, because, I mean, in general, especially in the drought seasons, bright green is not really the colour to go with. At the moment, everything's so dry and brown, he sticks out like a sore thumb, so to speak. Except, of course, when he's hidden in a crack of the bark like that. I don't know which particular species it is. I can tell you that it is not super venomous. It's not one of the Boothidae scorpions. It doesn't have that thick, thick, thick tail and really tiny pincers, which is, of course, the warning sign you want to watch out for, because it means that the scorpion concerned uses venom to kill its prey before it even thinks about grasping it with tiny little pincers. This one's sort of in between. Thick-ish tail, thick-ish pincers. You can't see the pincers at the moment, I'm sorry. But it's somewhere in between. I don't know which particular scorpion this is. It's a new one for me. I'm going to go and find it in my book. See what bright green bark scorpions are round about. Bark scorpion. I'm going with bark scorpion because it's living in the bark. But you just never know. It is absolutely freezing. The wind is howling, and I swear it's got colder, right, Dave? Mm. It has definitely got colder from when we first started the walk this morning. There's something horrendous that is blowing in. Just by the way, because I said to you you'd never know what had been digging in the ground, I will tell you, because I don't feel as though keeping you in suspense is ideal. We've moved away from the area now, but it was a porcupine, I suspect, targeting the roots of the monkey pods that were growing in that area. So we spoke about the fact that they can use the roots, or they do traditionally use the roots, as a fertility treatment and a blood cleanser. Perhaps we have a porcupine that's anxious for little porcupines wondering about quarantine. Not, of course, that I've seen a porcupine yet, since I started working at Safari Live and driving about Juma, but we know they're here, because they leave their evidence absolutely everywhere, wherever we go. We've stuck on quarantine, and the reason we've stuck on quarantine is because the weather's actually got worse, and we would really prefer not to be surprised by any large animals. Every now and again I think I hear elephants off to the south, and I've also smelt them at some point. So they are around. We're just going to keep scouring the place to see what we can find. Let's keep walking. We'll leave our scorpion to his hiding place, and I'm going to go and quiz Steph when we get back to camp. Steph, of course, being an expert in all things arachnid and otherwise, in terms of their different species and the different things we get. Oh! Speaking of different things we get, I forgot. So hold on one moment. Oh no! Finding lots and lots of insects to show you, but lots and lots, unfortunately, of deceased insects, is the tokkie that we picked up ages ago and I forgot that I had in my pocket. You know, it's not that I go around with little insect exoskeletons in my pocket all the time. This is called a tokkie beetle. And it's called a tokkie beetle because of tokkies. It taps its abdomen, its very hard wing casing, on the ground and creates a tok 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 sound. That sounds a bit like a hornbill, actually. Now that is a tokkie beetle, and he's given us the perfect opportunity to examine him. It's a tokkie beetle minus a head. Oh, it's a tokkie beetle that's blown away now. Tokkie beetle is gone. There we go. Here's our tokkie beetle. He's been completely eaten away. All that's left is his exoskeleton. Look, he's totally hollow. There's nothing in there. I'm trying to shelter him from the wind. He's blowing everywhere, making Dave's life very difficult. Especially because I keep headbutting Dave. Sorry, Dave. There we go. Eaten away, most likely, by ants. Okay, well, we'll return. Actually, no, I'm going to keep our tokkie beetle. You never know. For the next time there is a tent set up, we might as well have some new species of things to show in the tent itself. I'm looking for a nice warm termite mound, something that's going to provide a little bit of warmth. Oh, earlier on we started off our bushwalk with a scrub hare dung pellet. And we're seeing lots and lots of, a lot of animals utilize this open area as a safe spot. James Richard, how adaptable are scrub hares? Sure. I don't really know. I don't know that I would call them any more adaptable than most of the smaller animals out here. They are very widely distributed, James. So that does, I suppose, mean that they utilize a number of different habitats in terms of where they can go. Their digestive system, I suppose, means that they can make use of lots of different food sources, since they do digest it about 3 times before it is finally excreted. So I guess in that sense they are pretty adaptable. They're not... I don't think I would say that they're more adaptable than any of the other creatures, but they are widely distributed. So I suppose in that sense they might be, but leopards are also widely distributed. Leopards make use of all kinds of habitats and places that they can adapt to. I'm not sure about scrub hares. We could actually, while we walk along here, we could actually flush a scrub hare at some point. Right, I'm going to see if there's any warm air coming out of this termite mound, something that will heat me up in a pleasant way. While I do that, let's find out what was happening at the hyena den.
Nothing was happening at the den. We found one hyena there who took deep offense at our arrival. She booked off into the bush. And that was it. And that is just the way it is with the weather like it is now, I'm afraid. Sometimes you get lucky and sometimes you don't get lucky. Ooh, and we don't get lucky now. It's not with this gusting wind. I did see a waterbuck going through here. That's why I'm staring fervently into the bush. Hello, mobile Paddy. You saw the animals here holding up better than expected in the face of the drought that we have at the moment. Mobile Paddy, they are doing okay, yeah, absolutely. Remember, I don't think they're doing better than expected. I imagined that they were going to be doing pretty much like they are, because it's not so much now that the drought's going to take hold. The animals now look like September animals. They don't look like July animals. And we will only get rain probably in November, which means that there won't be a replacement of the forage until then. And that means it looks okay. Sorry, astounding nonsense on the game drive radio. They look fine for now, but they're not going to come August and September, I don't think. I think that's when we're really going to notice the effects of the drought and the very poor growth season that we had earlier. Not sure why I chose to come down here. There's a very startled looking impala there. See him, Bryan. He looks positively terrified. I think he's going to alarm call. Come to think of it, I'm not really sure what an unstartled impala looks like. They always, if they're looking up, they look startled. What do you see? Excuse me. Hello? Excuse me. What can you see? Brian, he's very rude.
He's very rude. Can't totally believe it.
So ask him again, shall we? Excuse me!
Hello?
Hello, that's it. Yes, look around. Hello? Extremely rude. It's highly unlikely that he's seen anything, I don't think. Because I don't think he'd be rushing in there if there was a predator. No, I think he's fine. Okay, let's carry on to the water. Rudest impala I've ever seen in my life. It was another impala there. Natasha, very nice question from you in Ontario. It's one of the colder parts of the world, of course. You say, do the animals huddle together in the nighttime here? Yes, they do. Especially the herding animals, obviously. And the ones that are always the most obvious to me are the buffalo. They like to huddle together during the cold winter nights. And you'll find them in the morning, great sort of clouds of steam rising off this great big black mass lying in a huddled group. They like to do that. The impala do as well, to a certain extent. I think you'll find that they all get slightly closer to each other. In the nighttime, but things like buffalo can, because they are large, which means that if there is a threat, they are able to defend themselves. If you are an impala and you happen to find yourself in the middle of a huddle, it's a bit like being in the middle of a bait ball of fish. Chances are you're going to get nailed. So while they do lie close-ish together, I think you'll find that it's pockets of them that are touching and the rest of them not so much. Nothing having a drink here. This is where we saw Mvula last night. I thought maybe he may have come back. And they do have tracks of a male leopard around Treehouse Dam, so we're going to head down in that direction. But I've got to tell you, today's temperature and general atmospheric conditions make me feel like it's going to be a fairly quiet day out in the wilderness. That's all right, Bryan. You know, we can't have action every day. True, true. We came tracking leopards through here 2 days ago when Jamie was driving and I was walking in the afternoon. And we had a very amusing interaction. I was sitting on a tree there as she came past with Herbert. It's always nice to do that, it's always nice to meet up in the bush. I can smell the wood fires of the camp, we're close to camp. But we shall have to go away from it again, Bryan, not for us the comforts of the fire this morning. No, no, for us the stoic life of the hunter of animals. And by hunter I mean looker for as opposed to murderer.
Observer,
yes. Very little in the way of fruits now. And you know, this bush here, the magic Gwarrie bush, which there are a few things that if a guide tells you, you must be very sure that you go home and ask for another guide. The first is that if the toothbrush story around the Gwarrie tree, because by now we should be telling slightly more original things about it, but it is actually quite a fun story. I'm not going to do it for you now, maybe another time. But the big thing about the Gwarrie bush is that it produces a very tasty red berry. But this year, the berries were really, really poor, and that's because of the water. And so all of those birds that would have depended on these berries, I think that you'll find that many young birds probably didn't make it through the first sort of growth season, and many of those that migrated north would have struggled to do that, and others will just not have laid on as much fat as they would have liked to before the winter time. And the Gwarrie bush, a very nice example of a tree that, yeah, the trees do okay, but they do sacrifice certain functions during drought times, and that of course has knock-on effects for everything else. Horrible to eat. No animals eat them, or just about no animals eat them, and that's why they're used so extensively for territory marking. Let me taste it. Would you like to taste it, Bryan?
I'll taste one, why not?
Why not, Bryan? It is absolutely disgusting. Sorry, Luigi, you're going to have to go again with Justin's corner question again. The game drive radio again exploded into my ear as you were asking. Oh, right. Justin, you want to know about bush remedies for the common cold. There are one or two sort of general purpose things that people use. You can apparently inhale the smoke of elephant dung in order to help with the sort of congested sinuses. I think that's highly likely to hurt you quite badly. And then also, there's a beautiful plant called Lipia javanica, or the Bushman's tea, and that's really good apparently for helping with the common cold. But it's much the same as with Western medicine, you know. They're not very good antivirals. They're good at giving you comfort, I think, in clearing out the sinuses, but your body's just got to process the virus of the common cold in order to survive. Orbs, confirm you've located there. Aubrey's been tracking a male leopard for a long time. No. We're going to going to head down towards that area anyway to help him, and we'll see what we can find there. We're now going past the Gwarrie Dam. Once we've gone through this incredibly bumpy drainage line. Right, let's go. Apparently the balletic figure of Jamie Patterson is now practicing her dancing in order to keep warm. Let's go and have a look.
It's not so much practicing dancing as just trying to raise the heart rate a little bit and warm up. There's been a suggestion that possibly we should do another fire making segment. Unfortunately, I don't have Steph's special cotton balls on me to act as kindling, plus any fire would probably be relatively tricky to make actually in this windy weather. What I was really hoping I was going to be able to show, it's getting worse, I can't stand it, it's horrible. It's howling. Lucky my microphone's hidden in my cap, or else you'd all be blown away by the sound of the wind. What I was going to say was, I was really hoping towards the end of our bushwalk we'd actually be able to do a segment with dwarf mongoose. The problem is, no self-respecting dwarf mongoose is going to come out for a long time, until this wind stops and until the sun comes out. So, to warm you all up on this winter's morning, of course for most of you it's summer, except for those of you who are watching in Australia and New Zealand, we have a quiz. I have a quiz for you, and it's a quiz about who deposited its excrement upon this termite mound, and we're going to have a closer look. So, which animal is responsible for that? And of course, as with everything, it's very important to get an all-round picture what it is you're looking at, but first a closer examination with hand for scale. There you go, hand for scale. That's how big it is. It has things in it. It has round things in it. It has round berries in it. Interesting shape. That's the size. And now, while we look at it, let's have a look at where we are. We're not quite on a termite mound, although we are almost. There's a lot of vents here. Just a word of advice, don't ever go sticking your hand in here or anything else. Don't ever try and poke around in these holes without checking first, or you're going to find yourself in a very uncomfortable position, because one thing that would really like to shelter in there, if it's not a dwarf mongoose, is a very large snake, including a black mamba or a spitting cobra or any other of our snake species. So if you have kids and they come out of the bush, don't let them go poking around in holes like that, please. Okay, here's the trick part of the question. Oh no, my earpiece has been blown out. Here's the trick part of the quiz. As we look around this, have a look at what is around it. It's a trick question. It's not what I think most of you are going to guess. Let's see if you can figure out whose dung that is. My apologies, my nose is actually starting to run, as are my eyes, in the wind. Okay, right. Ponder that. Ponder that and see if you can work it out. We're going to go find other things. Let's see what we can see. Just immediately. The termite. Oh, haha. Catherine. It is not a civet, and Claude's gate is definitely not a genet, because that the size of that poo is definitely way too big for a genet. A civet is a really good answer, and that's the one that I was going for to try and trick you guys. I'm going to almost give it away now, because I've just found more of it. Now, genets and civets. Genets are exceptionally good tree climbers, but they're very, very tiny. Their dung, or their scat actually, their feces, because they're almost omnivorous, probably about the size of my index finger. Much, much smaller. However, our animal responsible for that is not alone, because there's more of it. And there's more of it in a funny place. Now, there's one thing that civets don't do, is climb up trees and then defecate in them. So there you go. If you don't get it now, Well, I think that we definitely might be barking up the wrong tree. Yay! Well done, Dave. Yes, it is indeed a baboon. And if that wasn't a giveaway on the ground, that in the tree is a giveaway. That being said, I once found zebra dung in a tree about this high. So obviously, I don't know if the zebra had been busy scratching and just decided to defecate at the same time, but I did actually once find zebra dung at about this height. You never know what you might find up trees. But well done, Dave. It is indeed a baboon. The troop of baboon that obviously moved through here. It's quite old. I mean, it's sort of well and truly stuck on the remainders of this tree. This tree's been well and truly obliterated at this point by a combination of elephants. And you can actually see where it's coppiced. So it got broken off. The main stem got broken away. It ripped away a branch that bent out this way. And the tree coppiced, but unfortunately could not survive the ensuing probably wood borer and termite attack. And the termites, of course, are what's left this layer of soil all over it. Well, well done, bravo, you're all awake and not as cold as we are. And the brain is making my cold freeze. That was unintentional, believe it or not. The cold is making my brain freeze. I'm going to go do some more jumping jacks on a termite mound. While I do, let's head across, see how James is experiencing the weather this morning.
Well, we're going down towards Philemon's Dip, where we're hoping to find a male leopard. Now, we're on the road called Ingwer Alley, which means Leopard Alley. Now, there don't seem to be many leopards or anything else on this road at the moment. We might be lucky. I'm very pleased that Dave got the baboon poo right. Well done. Remarkable achievement for a Thursday morning. And especially from so far away. I think I know exactly the termite mound she's on, actually. Was there a smear? There's a nasty smear on a termite mound not far from camp. Ah, no, not a smear, apparently a log. Baboons, of course, leave the most disgusting poo, and they, of course, if they break into a room or something like that, then for some reason they just go everywhere, and you don't get rid of the smell for weeks. I've told a story once of a baboon that broke into my room, and it through a few of them destroyed the place, and I was away and somebody very kindly cleaned it up while I wasn't there, and everything was ship shape but for the disgusting smell that pervaded the area, until about 6 weeks later it came time for me to go on leave. And I took my bag down from the top of the cupboard, and I opened up the zip, and the very kind person who'd cleaned up the room had failed to notice was that the baboon had managed to relieve itself in the bag. And this very large pile of turd had ripened during the intervening 6 weeks in the midsummer. It had ripened and become utterly, utterly, beyond speech disgusting in the middle of my bag. I zipped the bag up, put it in the dustbin, and went to buy another one. Absolutely foul. Right, here we have a number of people who have been looking for the leopard. Let's get a quick update from them. Ah, hey! You come in, Zanuk Walan! Kui! Gardem! Okay. Right. Okay. So, this is a male leopard, everybody, that's been coming around here. And Ephraim says it's heading up towards Gwarrie Dam, which is up towards quarantine. So we'll just do a loop here. Good morning, everybody. Don't go far. I'm obviously just trying to freak them out so they panic. Because it's just quite funny. I'm going to turn round here and head back towards quarantine clearings, and let's see if he doesn't pop out there. I suspect it's Mvula. I suspect the reason he's quite difficult to find is that he's not marking his territory, so he's not sort of growling and sawing away like a territorial male leopard would. So we might be lucky on a day like today. Doesn't feel like it much, does it, Bryan?
No,
it doesn't. But who knows? No one's found anything, you know. There have been no elephants. Just those mating lions which disappeared into the drainage line. We found the buffalo, of course, Bryan. Many buffalo. Stout that we are. Hello again. Goodbye again. They must think I'm stark raving up the tree. And we also did find a giraffe, yes, and some impala. Let's not discount the noble impala, provider of food to so many predators around here. Oh, he's coming straight up the road here. Now the tracks are going straight up the road here. Shamsung, nice question from you about whether it's the female or the male leopard that goes after the other when it's time to mate. It's normally what happens is the female will start marking territory, and she's got, she will produce a pheromone. And that pheromone, I'm sorry, I'm just going to quickly call this in. Aubrey and Ephraim, the tracks head straight north up Philemon's Dip now. She will release a pheromone in her urine, not totally unconsciously. The male will pick that up. He'll seek her out. But also, she will seek him out once she starts coming into estrus. And then the female behaves in a manner that leaves you in no doubt as to how, as to what she wants. She, the wind has blown these tracks. She throws herself at the male once they find each other, and she will harass him for 4 or 5 days, and they will mate. I mean, we've seen them mating, what? We've seen them mating maybe 3 or 4 times every 20 minutes or so. It's quite astounding. Go ahead. Yeah, we'll just check here. Aubrey's just talking to me about where he thinks the tracks have gone. Yeah, copy. I had them going north up Philemon's Dip. There's an impala. Let's stop here. We'll just have a listen. We're now on quarantine clearings. Old hunting ground from Vula. I don't think these tracks are fresh. And that's not to say because I've looked at them and don't think they're fresh. I don't think they're fresh because the wind has been blowing so hard that it becomes almost impossible to tell what is fresh and what is not. There's also, I'm going to sneak forward, Bryan. There's a very nice lilac-breasted roller on the ground here. I don't know what it's doing on the ground. I suppose it must be hunting. You got it. Ah, yes. There we go. It's found itself a grasshopper or something. I was amazed that these birds find anything to eat, you know. When we walk through these areas, we don't find a great deal on the floor, other than those spiders and things. But a lot of them are under logs. And there we have a birchall starling, also looking for similar sorts of things to the roller, but slightly smaller. So they'll be largely trying to eat ants and termites, I suspect. Glistening metallically in the sunlight, very pretty. And there was also a hornbill knocking about here somewhere. There it is. very kind viewer from New Zealand, Lachlan. You're watching with your son, who's just written me a rap. Thank you very much, Lachlan, about the baboon in my room. Lachlan, I'm going to ask you to email that through, and then that can be further emailed to me. Louise did read it out to me, but I don't feel I'll do it justice by trying to remember it. And there we are. So I'll try and pick it up. That's great. Thank you very much, Master Lachlan. That's not an elephant. No, it's a tree. Now, the tracks don't come out here. But tracking in this weather, really, a bit of hit and miss. So we'll go down to the waterhole again and see what we can see there. Just on the corner. And it's always a reminder to me, you know, we drive around here, we're very, we actually, and it's always that we tend to get, well, around had a camp lying really on top of your game all the time when you're outside here. Right, Jamie has managed to find yet another wonderfully small thing to show you.
Herbert has managed to find yet another magically small thing. In this case, a really, really cool hairy caterpillar. The larva of some kind of butterfly, I imagine, maybe moth. The moth, in my experience, the moth caterpillars tend to be a little bit more stocky than the larval form of a caterpillar. In this case, I think we have a butterfly caterpillar. I don't know which particular one it is. I do know, however, that you... Oh, the wind's... Poor Dave is having to try and focus on something that's trying to blow away. But I do know that you really, 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 really don't want to touch one of these. So we spoke before about why you might... I'm sitting on a really uncomfortable thorn. It's distinctly unpleasant. But we'll address that at a later stage when I need to stand up. We spoke about the marula tree bark and how you can use it as an antihistamine. You would definitely need to utilize it if you touched one of these. They have incredibly itchy filaments on them that embed themselves in your skin and are exceptionally unpleasant when you do come into contact with them. This part is his head here. His head is here. And then this is the rest of his body. Now, the hairy caterpillar's defense doesn't actually always work, because it's a defense against getting eaten, and I know certainly I'm not going to eat him. Dave's probably not going to be brave enough to eat him, even if we are desperate for any sort of comfort food in the strange weather that we're experiencing. There are, however, certain bird species that love them. One of those is a caterpillar, Jamie. One of those is a cuckoo. And it was one of the theories that biologists put forward as to why brood parasitism came into existence. So the theory goes that cuckoos, who often feed off hairy caterpillars, their chicks can't cope with the filaments that are on the caterpillar and therefore have to be raised by another bird species. Very clever theory, but it actually doesn't work, because there is a type of bird, there's a couple of different birds that will eat a hairy caterpillar, one of which is a black-headed oriole or any of the oriole family, and they are most definitely not brood parasites. In other words, they raise their chicks themselves. They do not rely on any of the other bird species to do it for them. Now, most of our cuckoos have flown for warmer shores and warmer climes and possibly even better food sources, because insects are pretty thin on the ground at the moment at this time of year. Most of our reptiles are estivating. They're hiding away. Hello, James. Oh, how very pleasant. James just gave us a thumbs up, sort of. You just mixed up a few fingers. Bye, James. I want to show you something else quickly as James races away. Where's it gone now? Oh, there it is. There it is. The remains of some poor hapless creature. Some sort of antelope. We don't know which one it is. Guessing by the size, I would say maybe an impala or something similar. Can have a look at the molars, the jagged teeth. This is an old kill. But what I really want to show you actually is on the other side of this bone. So while we just have a quick look at the teeth, and then I'm going to flip it around and show you something. And all of the skulls out here have these sorts of things. Ours do as well, of course, naturally. Look at this hole here. Now that is present on every single mammal skull. We've got a few of them around, but you'll often see them around the jaw. And that is a passage for a tendon attachment, but also for nerve cells. Nerves and blood vessels that then supply the rest of the jaw, which is of course living bone. And most importantly in this case, leading into the base of the jaw and the base of the teeth where the roots sit. And what it does is it actually supplies the teeth with the nerves, so that's why it hurts so much whenever you get some kind of infection in your root, where you have to have root canal, which gives me shivers just thinking about it. And that's actually where the nerves travel through. So the nerves obviously come from the brain, which would be sitting up somewhere here, and in the case of an impala, relatively small thing, about the size of, or just larger than a golf ball. And then the nerve passages that travel through into the jawbone. And those nerves will spread out, they'll supply the teeth, but also the nimbleness of the lips. All of that is controlled by sensory give and take. So the way motor neurons versus sensory neurons, the whiskers all around the face, those crucial parts of an animal's sensory understanding of their world, that all comes from the nerve cells responding. So that is called... I can't remember what it's called. How terribly unfortunate. It was there when I started this segment. I promise you the name was in the... It's in the frontal part of my lobe, on the tip of my tongue. I can't remember. I absolutely cannot remember, but it has a specific anatomical name, and it's gone. Here's the other half of the jaw. I'm going to try and remember what on earth it's called. It's going to bug me endlessly until I figure it out. While I do, let's go see how James is doing, heading up for your telemain access.
What?
We greet you again with the wind to show you, and the pounding clouds driving gale into our faces. Bryan, do you think it's got any warmer since we've begun our drive?
No,
I don't either. I think it may have even got colder.
Me too.
Brr. Anyway, nice to see Jamie there on walk. She was walking when we saw her. Of course, she was sitting cross-legged, as only someone of her flexibility is able to do. Not so, Bryan. I know you can, but you're very flexible. You were part of the circus.
I was.
Yes. That's not a joke, everyone. Bryan was indeed in the circus.
On the flying trapeze.
On the flying trapeze. It is the most incongruous thing in the world to think about Bryan swinging from a big top somewhere in the middle of Thailand, was it?
Yep.
I have never been part of a flying trapeze, everybody. I believe I'm too small. Don't you have to be quite tall, Bryan?
You'd be the right size.
Oh, I'd be the right size. Maybe I should take it up. Maybe I should find a circus nearby and join them for a brief stint on the fly. On the flying trapeze. I think in order to warm up, everybody, I'm going to have to climb a tree. Bryan says I should climb a termite mound because it's a bit safer. I think I'm going to have to find a tree to climb.
Look how big this termite mound is.
Which one? This termite mound here? Bryan, that termite mound is very small. Don't say anything about it being the right size for someone like me. That would be unkind. If you're a termite, it's quite big, yes. Well done, Louise, well pointed out. I'm astounded by the absence of mammal life around here. We did go down to the waterhole, everybody. There wasn't anything there. It's not untypical. It's simply because it's not hot, and so animals don't need much to drink. And so they don't come around here to find things to drink. There were some warthogs living in a little sounder around this area. But they all too seem to have absconded. I'm wondering if we shouldn't have just sat at Buffelshoek Dam with those hippos. What do you think, Bryan? And the zebra that were coming to and fro, hither and yon. Can't even find a tree to climb. Anyway, so it goes. Hang on. What's that up ahead? Something strangely coloured. Oh, you know what it is, Bryan? It's a tree that's changed colour in the winter. I'll show you exactly what I saw. I saw that thing there. You see that thing there lying on the ground? What does it look like to you, Bryan?
A pile of leaves.
It does look like a pile of leaves, but from a distance, if you were really hoping to see something, what do you think it might have looked like?
An ostrich.
No, that is incorrect. I'm going to give you one more guess.
Crocodile.
Not a crocodile, no. No, you've left your brain at home. Yeah, I thought it might be a lion, everybody. I thought that the colour resembled that of the tawny pelage of a great hunting lion. Instead, it is indeed, as Bryan correctly pointed out, a pile of leaves that are tawny coloured, which of course indicates to us why a lion would want to be tawny coloured, a very good colour if you wish to hide out here and stalk things to eat for breakfast, which makes me hungry. It's a fry up today, Bryan. No, I think today is muffin day. Muffin day is never our best day, everybody. Gail, you're in Australia and you make an excellent, excellent point. You say, are we not all part of a circus here? Yes, I think we probably are all part of a circus here. Chief, who's clown in chief, do you suppose? Thank you very much, Bryan. Bryan says I am the clown in chief. I don't think Brian's too far off being clown in chief myself. Leo Smith, of course, who returns today, he's the loudest clown in history. Elegant clown, Jamie. Red clown, Kirsten. Curly clown, Jerry. Guns clown, Louise. Baldy clown, Steph. What can David be? He's also a bit of a curly clown. Cheesecake clown can be Jerry. Dave can be curly clown. Ah, yes. Let's look up the drainage line and just see if we haven't missed a leopard. Can you see a leopard up there anywhere, Bryan? Just put the camera up there and let's see if we can spot a leopard. Do you see one?
No.
I don't see one either, which I find greatly surprising. There we go. Jamie wants to know what clown Dave is. I think Dave is curly clown. Jerry can be cheesecake clown. Chelsea can be American clown. Oh, well spotted, Bryan. It's a Steinbok. Super zoom. Female Steinbok grazing oblivious to Brian's laser-like glare. Don't run away. Stand still. Stay there. Good. Now, We were asked about peristalsis earlier. Oh, can you believe it? Only reason we saw that animal is because it didn't think it could be seen. Let's go down to Treehouse Dam and have a look there. It's not too far from here. Herbert will have to be rifle clown or security clown. I am chief clown, Louise. Chief clown. Chief clown. You may call me chief clown from now on, Louise. Here we go. And who else are we missing? We're missing anyone else. Chelsea's American clown. Then, oh, there's Amanda. We have to have cooking clown. And then VM. I think VM should be the abominable clown. And the abominable clown because he has not cut his hair or his beard since he arrived here for work some 7 weeks ago. Which now means that he looks like a sort of small, abominable snowman. Like a small Bigfoot, almost. I'm trying to convince him to shave his head. Right, the elegant clown has mercifully found something useful to show you, so let's head across to her.
I think that Herbert should be clever clown, because he's found us all kinds of extraordinary things on our bushwalk today. I'm speaking quite softly, and the reason is because I don't...
Now, bushwalk, of course, does that entirely on cue on a daily basis. At this time of the day, picture gone. And that's because the batteries are running out. So I think that will be the end of bushwalk for the day. They did very well, found lots of nice little things today, while Bryan and I have found waving leaves in the weather. Well done, Bryan.
Well done, James.
Yes, thank you very much. We're now heading to Treehouse Dam, where we expect to find Bryan.
More wind and leaves.
Yes, more wind and running leaves scudding across the skyline. If we're very lucky, we'll get a bit of blue sky that is changing from blue sky to grey sky on account of the running clouds. Very nice. Hello, Gary. You want to know who the ringleader of the circus is? Well, I mean, as the chief clown, I suppose from a clown point of view, I must be. But the actual ringleader would be Baldy Clown. He is he is our fearless leader on site here. I don't think we're going to give clown names to Graham Wallington and his wife because we might not have work anymore. Ah, yes. Aaron in New Zealand, very nice. Gendre, who also returns today, needs a clown name. Some might say, yes, Hoppy Clown, because, of course, most of the time he has some sort of severe foot injury and is unable to walk. Yes, Hoppy Clown would be good. I think Dreadlock Clown also might be a good one for him. Gendre has decided that his hair knows how to wash itself. I'm not joking. He has decided to eschew technology in favor of what nature has intended, and he has decided that his hair will be able to clean itself. So far, the odor emanating from his scalp would indicate that this is not, in fact, the case. Not so, Bryan. We'll get him to tell you about that when he comes back this afternoon. It'll be interesting to know if he's cleaned his hair during the course of his holiday. I'm not being nasty here. I mean, he will tell you this himself. He looks a little bit, you know, the hair, he looks like Mowgli. Ah, yes. Jen, you want to know what clown Connor is? Connor is a drone clown. Flying clown. Yes, flying clown. That's what he can be. Flying clown, yes. I know exactly what tree I'm going to climb. Bryan, are you nervous for me?
I am. Are you sure you won't reconsider a termite mound?
I am not going to reconsider and climb a termite mound negative, Bryan. I'm going to climb the tree in which George and Charlotte were last seen, and I'm going to poke my head out from under the branches and give you a wonderful view. I'm going to park you right here. No, I'm not. Move a little bit off. There we are. I shall be in that tree there, Bryan. It is a Scotia brachypatella, weeping boorbean. I think you will probably lose sound from me for briefly, but I shall scuttle down through there. I might scuttle back up very quickly if something vicious is there. I might have to take this off, Bryan, for climbing needs to be done with maximum agility. Can you still hear me?
Yes.
Can you still hear me?
I can.
Wonderful. Now? Amazing. Now, it was into this tree that I watched Charlotte climb. Charlotte, of course, is a very good climber. I don't think I can get into this tree, Bryan. Maybe a termite mound. I've managed. Can you see me, Bryan? Oh, what a joy! Karula did not leave a diker for me up here, everybody. Ridiculous as this is, I am now thoroughly warm. Bryan, are you jealous? Yes. Now, this tree, boorbean, and now, it's a weeping boorbean, everybody. And it's weeping because of the red flowers, beautiful red flowers, which we didn't even get this year because of the drought. They produce a lovely sort of sweet nectar that drips out of them onto the ground. That's why it's called weeping. A boer is an Afrikaans term for farmer, and I'm not sure why it should be named a farmer's bean. A crying farmer's bean, but I do know, actually, we were told. There is a bean in it that is eventually produced in the flower that can be used as a coffee substitute. And if you were on the Great Trek, that mythological movement of Afrikaner people from the Cape of this country circa 1830 to 1840, well, then coffee was in short supply. And while you were eating your rusks, aka stale bread, you needed something to dunk them in. And the coffee made from one of these things, one of these trees, would probably have made an adequate substitute. Okay, Bryan. I think I should come back now. I just don't know how I'm going to get out of this tree. Double back flip. No. No, no, no. Don't be silly. Ooh. I'll tell you what I'm going to bring you, though, Bryan. I'm going to bring you a snack. Mmm. It's a bit of tree gum. I'll put it in my pocket. Here I come. Oh, gosh. Death is nigh. Oh. This is terrifying, Bryan. Here I come. Fearlessly diving down. I'm much warmer now, Bryan. Do you actually have a rusk with you?
No, I don't.
Have you eaten him?
I have.
I wanted to show people a rusk.
Next time.
Next time. I'm just trying to find Brian's snack. It's not a big snack, obviously. I've got it, Brian. I've lost it again. I can see it. Wait. It will be worthwhile, everybody, I promise. For goodness sakes. I can't find your snack, Brian. It's the same.
No,
you won't have it. It's the same as that one. You see there? It's tree gum. It's rather good to eat. See it? Very nice. Tree gum. Yum, yum.
I'm disappointed.
I'm sorry about that. I've got it in my pocket here somewhere, Brian. It's just not really big. Now, everyone, I've told them. The great trek, which was a sort of migration of tax-evading slave runners from the Cape up over the Drakensberg on, if you take the cynical version, which is where I tend to sit, or if you take the more romantic version, some pioneers heading out away from the domination of the British in the Cape, well, they came up here. These are the white settlers, the Afrikaner settlers, and they came up into this area. They left the Cape around sort of 1830-ish. It's a long way away. And during the course of their great trek up here, they were in ox wagons, much like the pioneers of the West, of the US West, I guess. And they had to make do with what they had. They read the Bible a great deal. In High Dutch, there were no schools. They had guns, and they had to make do with what they could off the land. And so they would have used the weeping boer bean, they would have used Sisyphus, they would have used any number of other plants as substitutes for things that they didn't have to eat. Well, one of the things that they created is something that we call a rusk. Now, a rusk, in most parts of the world, is known as stale bread. You'd dismiss it out of hand as a food source and throw it into the dustbin. Here in South Africa, it's considered a delicacy. And you can imagine if you were on yon ox wagon moving across the trail, when your bread became hard and stale in the sun, you didn't eschew eating it because it meant, you know, probably throwing away food you weren't going to eat for the next 3 days. And eventually you mixed it with a bit of sugar, and eventually it became so hard that it is utterly inedible unless you dip it into a hot drink like coffee. And so it used to amuse me no end when I was a guide. And you know, you have tea in the mornings, and your guests would come out of their rooms freezing cold and looking forward to their safari, and they'd come and they'd stand at the tea table and you'd pour them a piping hot cup of delicious coffee, and then they'd be faced with a choice. They'd either have what they call in Britain a flapjack, or what we call here a crunchy, which is a sort of a compacted oat biscuit, very nice, or you'd have this thing called a rusk. And they, you know, the more brave of them would take the rusk out, and they'd sort of shake it a bit, and then they'd test it with their teeth, and you know, some of them would crack their teeth, and they'd put it back down. But mostly they'd be deeply confused as to what on earth it was until you explained to them that in order to make it vaguely edible, you had to dip it into the coffee and then eat it. And some people were converted to it, and some people just thought this was utterly ridiculous. And Jen Ward, I don't know where you're getting hold of us from, but you say an Omar, which means grandmother, an Omar buttermilk rusk. Omar is the brand of most popular rusks out here. Brian ate how many today?
I ate three
today. Jen, what do you say you want an Omar buttermilk rusk? I got to tell you, I don't think they're quite what they once were. I think they've changed the recipe again and again to make them cheaper and cheaper. And now they just taste like sort of sweet margarine. which I think is a bit sad. I used to love them as a kid, though, dipping them in your tea or your coffee. And, of course, the other delicacy that around the world is considered starvation rations is what we call biltong. And people out here, will, I mean, they'll kill for biltong. And biltong, everybody, is the same as jerky. In other words, it's dried, uncooked meat that in most parts of the world people wouldn't consider eating. But we out here, we think it's delicious. Don't we, Bryan? Because we're savages. Yes, Wild Earth Girlie, you say it was you. You almost broke your teeth on a rusk. It's always been an amazing thing to me that we give these things to unsuspecting tourists and describe them as delicacies. People often come out here and they say, well, you know, talk us through the local cuisine. What have you got? And the truth of the matter is there isn't much. Because the area is... there's very little in the soil, so none of the plants here, I mean, you don't get the sort of rich flavors that you do of Europe or the East. Those kind of rich, spicy flavors just don't occur here. And one of the things that people eat out here in and around this area and much further north into Zambia and southern Ethiopia, I think it goes as far as, and I've mentioned this before, is the mapani worm. And the mapani worm is a caterpillar of a very beautiful moth called an emperor moth, and people eat these things. And they're described in these sort of, they're described in tourism bumf and brochures, and these tourism brochures and things will describe the mapani worm as a delicacy. Now, delicacy to me means that it's got to taste like something interesting and probably be even delicious, or very unusual tasting. A mapani worm is dried in the sun and it tastes like sawdust that's been mixed with a bit of offal. And while that's not delicious, it's not particularly offensive either. It's not a delicacy, it's an extremely important part of the diet. I mean, people really need to eat it because there are lots of very poor people between here and the northern reaches of Zambia. So I think often these things that we term delicacy, probably like crickets in the Far East, they're just what people have to eat. And Gary, you say the only rusk you know of is teething rusks. Yes, you do get teething rusks, don't you? That's supposed to help kids with their teething. Sally, you're right. I mean, a rusk is basically biscotti, a slightly less sophisticated version of biscotti. And you say biscotti is as hard. It is, but at least they give you biscotti in something, you know, that you can bite. A rusk, of course, is normally served to you, I mean, it's sort of almost like a roll. It's like a bread roll size thing. So you get your mouth and teeth right into it. You really got to be quite skilled. Ooh, some red-billed buffalo weavers in this tree. And now flying away. Oh, there's one more. It's not a red-billed buffalo weaver. It's a very upset virtual starling. And it's upset, Bryan, because it's tired of the wind. Okay, I think it's time we went home for breakfast, don't you, Bryan?
I do.
Yes, indeed. For our muffin breakfast.
Hooray!
Combined with lots of lovely coffee. Not for you.
No
coffee for Bryan, everybody. He doesn't like coffee. All right, everyone, that's going to be it from us for this morning. hopefully a little bit more luck this afternoon. I'm not sure who's going to drive. It'll be Brent, me, or Jamie, or the combination of that. Thank you, Bryan, for your efforts today. Big thank you to Louise in the final control, being ably assisted by Geraldine, the Cheesecake Kent, and Jamie, Herbert, and David on the walk. Wonderful to have them with us. Thank you mostly to all of you who came along for our quiet, blustery, but very pleasant drive this morning. Until later, bye-bye.